Today's Southwest Conference game is brought to you by Budweiser. Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by Gatorade, the official thirst quencher. From Floyd Casey Stadium in Waco, Texas, Home Sports Entertainment presents a Diamond Anniversary production. Today, the Baylor Bears host the Aggies of Texas A&M. Hi, everybody. I'm Bill Worrell, and we welcome you on this beautiful Saturday afternoon to Waco, Texas, for the Battle of the Brazos. The Texas Aggies and the Baylor Bears, and they've been going at it in this long and spirited series since 1899. And this is an awfully big game for both of these schools today, and we'll show you why. Both Baylor and Texas A&M are 2-1 in the Southwest Conference, and both schools still have to play Arkansas and Texas. So the winner of today's game would go on for the big matchups and a trip possibly to the Cotton Bowl. The loser would most probably be eliminated from Cotton Bowl contention. Well, it's our pleasure to welcome to Mike's side today Lamar University coach and good friend Ray Auburn. And Ray, as a player in the Southwest Conference and a coach, you know what a big battle this is for A&M and Baylor. Most importantly for the Aggies, because they're coming off a big, big win over Houston.
Yeah, I would think if R.C. Slocum's probably a little bit concerned about how they're going to their mental frame of mind will be today. I talked to John David Crow a minute ago, and he seemed to think that they're on a pretty even keel. So he felt like they would be ready to play. Obviously, there's a lot at stake, as you mentioned earlier, so both teams should be ready to play. I would be, as I said, a little bit concerned, but I think, listening to John David, they ought to be all right, so it ought to be a heck of a football game.
Baylor, when Brad Gable is on, the Bears are on.
I think his performance, of course, is key. He's been a little bit inconsistent, and whether he can hold up to the A&M rush as they used against last week against Houston will certainly be critical, but I think if he's hot, Baylor's got a chance in the football game.
A&M Lombardi candidate Aaron Wallace is sick from top to bottom today. He has strep throat, and he also is coming off a turf toe suffered against Houston. He may not play. Will that hurt the Aggies?
Oh, I would think it definitely would hurt him. He's a great football player, and anytime you lose a guy out of your defense, he wouldn't be the starter if he wasn't the best.
Yeah.
And so I think it'll have an impact, but they've got a lot of good players behind him. I wouldn't be too concerned.
Yeah. Well, it's the Aggies and the Baylor Bears, the battle of the Brazos bragging rights at stake today here in Waco, and we'll be back with the kickoff on HSE in just a moment.
Must be a Lennox.
And Baylor decided to take this win, and it will be a factor today, coming out of the Southwest to the backs of the Baylor Bears at about 15 to 20 miles per hour. And Jeff Ireland will be kicking off for Baylor, Larry Horton and Cornelius Patterson deep for the Aggies. And boy, he kicks it right on through the end zone. So Texas A&M will set it up now at the Aggie 20-yard line.
Bill, Jeff Ireland kicked two from 61 yards in the pregame warm-up there, so to give you some idea about the strength of his leg and the way the wind is blowing down here.
Offensively for A&M, Lance Pavlis, the quarterback, coming off of a super game against the University of Houston last week. And Pavlis is having a good junior campaign. There he is, number 12. He's thrown for 3 touchdowns and 7 interceptions on the season. That's a big front line in front of him, and Pavlis will throw on first down against the wind. He's going long. He's got Patterson at the 45. Off his fingertips, incomplete.
He had the tight end. Tight end Mike Jones was wide open across the middle there. They just missed him.
Big offensive line for the Aggies. Mike Arthur at center. Darren Groot. Well, let's go with the Aggies' backs and receivers to start with. Darren Lewis and Robert Wilson. They rushed for over 100 yards apiece against the Cougars last week. Cornelius Patterson, who that last pass was intended for. Percy Waddle and Mike Jones. The offensive line blocks out the sun. They are so big. Richmond Webb at 291. Groot at 330. And Matt McCall at 314. Second down now, 10 needed for the Aggies. Pavlis will throw one more time. Big rush by Baylor, and a big collision at the 18-yard line. Gary Joe Kinney, the middle linebacker for the Bears, and boy, did he sniff that one out.
That's the old run and shoot screen there, Bill. And they had the linebacker, apparently was manned up on the fullback. see him throw the ball. He kind of jumps to throw it over the defender's head.
Yeah, I'll tell you, Harry Joe Kenny was right there to put the helmet right on the numbers. And even though James Francis gets most of the preseason pub, Kenny leads the Bears in tackles. And it'll be third down now. A&M needs 10 for a first. Pavlis throws it across the middle, intended for his tight end, I think, Mike Jones. Good defense by Gary Joe Kenny, and Baylor holds on downs. Robin Jones, Santana Dotson out of Houston, Reggie Howard, John Godfrey across the front line. The Baylor Bears very proud of their linebackers. James Francis, the Lombardi candidate. Gary Joe Kenny leading the team in tackles. And the backs punting now from inside the 10-yard line is Sean Wilson. And it's going to drive Greg Anderson back, and it takes a Baylor bounce and killed at the Baylor 42-yard line. So not a real good kick by Wilson, and already a little physical activity on the Baylor sideline.
Bill, strangely enough there, the Aggies killed the ball and turned around and went away, walked away from it. If Baylor had picked it up, they had the option of taking it right there at that spot, even if they'd fumbled it.
Brad Gable, 70 for 129, will lead the Baylor attack. Gable needs about 800 yards to pass Cody Carlson and become the best thrower in the history of Baylor football. He'll be leading the Baylor attack. The Bears now will set it up at the 44-yard line. There he is, the junior out of Cuero, Texas, Brad Gable. He'll have Eldwin Raphael and Jeffrey Murray in the backfield. They're not going to run. They're going to throw and use that win. It's to Murray, the leading receiver for Baylor. He's got big running room into A&M territory at the A&M 45-yard line. The ball was fumbled but picked up by a Bear. Anthony Williams made the tackle. Jeffrey Murray leads this team with 28 catches on the season. Raphael is the leading rusher. David Frost, Greg Anderson, very good possession receivers. Stutzman is a good tight end, and he can catch the football. Big, big. John Turnpaugh at 330 pounds, the big man across the front for Baylor. Monty Jones, a good young sophomore out of Tomball, also a very good blocker at right guard. So the gain will put the ball at the Texas A&M 42-yard line. First down for Baylor.
Bill, there hadn't been a running play yet.
There hasn't been. These two teams have come out firing away. Now we're going to have Raphael, and he's inside the 40 to about the 37-yard line before Kevin Tucker, the freshman out of Angleton, wraps him up for the Aggies. Now the Aggies get a lot of credit for going with only one defensive lineman against the run and shoot last week at Houston, but they'll go back to their conventional defense today. Terry Price, Patrick Henry, and Kevin Tucker. They have done an awfully good job this season. Aaron Wallace is on the field with Anthony Williams, Jeroy Robinson, and William Thomas. Thomas coming off a huge game against Houston. He had 3.5 quarterback sacks last week on Andre Ware. Pitch back to Raphael around the left side, inside the 35 to about the 33. Anthony Williams, who played his high school ball at Waco High, he made the tackle.
Third down, a little bit short.
Williams moved in. He was a proposition 48 last season for the Aggies, but when John Cooper got hurt about 3 weeks ago, Williams moved right into that starting lineup against Texas Tech, and they haven't been able to dislodge him. Third down. The Bears need a yard. And they give it to Lincoln Coleman, and he's got it across left guard. First down, Baylor, behind big blocks by Terry Gray and John Turnpaugh. Look at that Turnpaugh. Gray, he is huge.
That ought to be two scholarships, Bill. That guy's a judge. I can't hardly believe he's 330.
Well, they got right in behind him. Lincoln Coleman at 215, a transfer from Notre Dame. He had to sit out last year.
Bill, I understand that Lou Holtz said that he would have been starting for them up there this year, up at Notre Dame.
First and 10, Baylor. At the A&M 30-yard line, Greg Anderson out wide, one of the dual receivers, along with David Frost. Murray goes in motion. And Raphael gets the football, brought down by Mickey Washington, the first player to get to him. Washington, a senior out of Beaumont.
Bill, right now, Baylor is putting the formation to the wide side of the field and running back into the short side away from the strength of the formation. In this area, usually people begin to think a little bit more of blitz, try to come up with a big play to slow their progress down. So A&M may be thinking blitz, and Baylor certainly is probably anticipating.
Ball on the A&M 28-yard line, second down. Gable needs eight. Raphael, the lone setback. Gable across the middle, receiver wide open at the 15-yard line. Reggie Miller, a freshman out of Waco, with a catch. And boy, did Larry Horton put a hit on him. I think his mouthpiece went flying out, and we get a replay.
Right. Here it comes. Watch it fly toward the A&M sideline.
Watch the hit Horton puts on him. Watch the mouthpiece now. Boom!
Can't see it.
Horton, of course, was put on defense this year. Hand off in the backfield. Fumble by Baylor, and he recovered it. It looked like it was Raphael, the bottom of the pile. Good job by James Webb, the sophomore out of Dallas, the brother of Richmond Webb. And he played a lot against Houston last week. He really got in that backfield in a hurry, Ray.
Yeah, he did. You can't see it up at the top of the screen. They brought it. Looked like the strong safety or the Willie linebacker, weak side linebacker from up at the top of the screen. That was a great job by Webb. And he's getting whipped out here this time.
Loss of six on the play. Second down. Baylor needs 16. Lee Miles checks into the game now for the Bears. The Bears are overloaded to the top of your screen. Looks like somebody was offsides. They're going to blow the play dead.
It's some movement, I think, in the Baylor offensive front.
Could have been Terry Gray or Turnpaul, one of the two on the left side. We'll wait and see. The officials today, Wendell Shelton is your referee. Bill Voss, Don Brown, Mike Leiner, Tommy Moore, George Coleman, and Randy McAnally. Let's hear Wendell.
Disregard the flag. Disregard the flag. We'll replay second down.
I've seen that before.
Well, at the tight end, he can move.
Right. I think what happened is the linesman on this side threw the flag because the A&M guy, Webb, jumped upfield. And apparently he nullified and said he got back. Coach Taft's talking with him down there about it.
Yeah, he wanted an explanation, apparently got the one that satisfied him.
Right.
So it'll be second down, 16 again. The ball still on the A&M 21-yard line. It's been a good drive for Baylor. Started back at the Baylor 42. We've played 5 minutes now into the first period. Gable to Raphael, big hole right side. He's down to the 15-yard line before William Thomas can bring him down, the junior out of Amarillo.
That was a nice job, just kind of a sprint play to the open inside. Good block by the fullback. Good job of carrying the football. And got his pads down right here.
Yeah, he did. And Ray, you know, Mark Bass, the starting center for Baylor, is out of today's game. Scott McCool is starting in his place. He made a nice block along with Monty Jones.
Right. The whole right side of the offense. But now he's checking based on their coverage.
He needs to get
here
it down
comes
to the
blitz.
Five. First down. A&M with that blitz. Baylor picked it up nicely, but he threw it out of bounds intended for Greg Anderson. And Anderson made his cut right at the 4-yard line, but Gable overthrew him.
Bill, that was a really nice drive by Baylor, and they had the one big play for a loss by Webb. And they need to come out of here with some points on the board, particularly with the wind at their back right now.
Well, they've got the right man for it. One of the best kickers in the country right now, Jeff Ireland for Baylor. He'll be kicking. His holder is Kent Brimham. His snapper is Scott McCool. And this will be from the 21-yard line. Tack on 10, a 31-yard attempt. It's up, and it's good. Jeff Ireland now is 9 of 12 in the field goal department this season. So the Bears take the opening drive in for 3 points. And with 9:05 left to play in the first quarter, Baylor takes a 3-0 lead over the Texas Aggies. We'll be back with more college football on HSE in just a moment. New all-pro turf field. As you see how green it appears on your television set, it's just installed this year, and it's part of the rebuilding and renovation of Floyd Casey Stadium. They're spending millions here at Baylor.
Bill, I was down on the field before the game, and it is really a nice surface. I feel like it had a good grip, but it wasn't, you know, when you walked on it, didn't just grip you like some do.
Jeff Ireland kicks off. Horton and Patterson are deep, and again, it will go out of the end zone. You try to keep it away from Larry Horton. He already has one for 92 yards this season.
Well, that was a great drive by the Baylor Bears. 5 minutes and 55 seconds, of course, with the wind. And it's important that they be able to hold on to the football as long as they can. That takes a lot of pressure off their defensive football team.
Both teams came out throwing, Ray. Were you a little surprised that maybe we didn't see Lewis and Robert Wilson?
Yeah, I was. A&M threw three passes. The first one was a play action, which would be a good call. Had people open, it just wasn't complete.
Wilson is a hoss at 240. He's in the front of that I formation. The ball will go to Lewis. Spins around over the middle and up across the 20 to about the 23-yard line.
He made that pretty much on his own. There wasn't a great deal of daylight in there for him to run to. It was a pretty good job of hitting and spinning.
Curtis Hafford made the tackle along with James Francis for Baylor. Last week, Darren Lewis had an 84-yard run against the Houston Cougars. He started celebrating at about the 15, and it cost him a touchdown.
Right.
Formation again. It'll be Lewis going wide to the right. Got a couple of blocks to the 25. Robert Blackman really came up from his strong safety position along with Mike Welch. When you say Blackman and Welch, you're saying a mouthful.
Yeah, you're talking about two guys that are highly regarded by the pros. I saw Robert Blackman in high school down at Van Vleck. Was a quarterback. Really a very talented athlete. Could have played on either side of the football. Pick down for the Aggies here now. Third and about four into the wind. They need to come up with a first down here.
The Baylor bench imploring the fans to get up and make some noise. Third down, needing four for Pavlis. And it's going to be some contact at the 30. Yes, I think that James Francis got to the receiver just a little early. It was intended for Darren Lewis out of the backfield, but Francis just had him smothered.
James Francis defended. There are flags on the front.
It's too bad he couldn't see that the ball was not going to be catchable. That's one of those judgments that players have to make.
Defense, first down.
Well, you know, in college football, they don't say who it's on, but it was pretty obvious it was James Francis. There was just a one-on-one play.
Right.
Boy, he is a big one, isn't he? At 6'4", 248. And Lewis, after a very slow start this year, and many thought he would be in the race for the Heisman, but the first three games took him right out of that race. He tried to get back in it last week.
You know, one of the things, Bill, that was in the Waco paper today, he was talking about the emergence of Robert Wilson at fullback and how that had taken the pressure off of him.
First down and 10 A&M. Lewis looking for some running room. Good pursuit by Baylor. Santana Dotson cut it off, and James Francis completed the tackle. Santana Dotson, very active at 6'5", 264. He's a sophomore out of Yates High School in Houston.
Middle linebacker Gary Joe Kenny did a great job of getting upfield there and taking the guard on before he got turned up and caused him to bounce it back inside.
Second down for Pavlis. He needs eight. Split backfield. Makes it. He'll go to Lewis. Who got a hand on it? I think it was Yerrick Long, number 48, the senior of Hearn, Texas, right up the road from Waco.
Baylor came with both backers on the blitz and did a good job, and they had the swing, had the right call, and they just didn't get the football to him.
That's the way you coach it too, Ray, when you're bearing in on a quarterback. Get those hands in the air.
Exactly. That's just a good athletic play right there.
So it brings up now a big third down play for A&M. 7-10 left in the first quarter. Baylor leads it 3-0. Pavlis. Oh, Dotson had him in his sights, and Pavlis throws it away. Santana Dotson.
They had a little loop twist up front, and he did a great job of coming around the horn and containing it, got his hands up, and caused the play to cause Pavlis to throw the ball over the receiver's head.
So far, Baylor has done an excellent job of taking Mike Jones out of the offense for A&M. He is the favorite target for Pavlis. So far, Pavlis only 1 for 5. Sean Wilson will kick it inside his 20-yard line. Greg Anderson back deep. Oh, it's blocked.
Francis,
can he get to it? Nope, it's safety. Out of the end zone. A safety Baylor. James Francis, the All-American. Second block punt this season.
Bill, that's a great individual effort by that fellow. The personal protector blocks him. You can see the personal protector blocks him, and he just sticks his hands up and comes right to him.
Well, remember now, he was a star for the Baylor basketball team 2 years ago. What a power forward at 6'4", so you know he can get up in the air.
I had the opportunity to see him play a couple times. I'm up here visiting my son. What a great athlete. And great size. He and Wallace both are what the pros are looking for.
Oh, what a turn of events. That's why you call him All-Americans. That's why he's a Lombardi candidate, because of the big plays these people are able to make.
That's exactly right. When you get into ball games like this, the guys that are the guys you count on are the guys that come up with the big plays when they have to have them, and that's certainly a big play. Now Baylor scores. They may anticipate going for 2 points. Let's see, it would make it 11. No, they wouldn't necessarily want to do that. But, that puts a whole different complexion on the football game now.
Well, I guess it does. Of course, Francis decided last year to give up basketball. He saw that his future was going to be in pro football, and he wanted to beef up. And I'll say he beefed up. He was at about 227. Now he's at about 247.
I would think he made a valid contribution to the basketball program, but I think he really helped himself as far as his future in pro football by spending that time in the weight room.
Well, now, Ray, I think the Aggies really have a problem here in that the Baylor has taken this ball game over in the early going, and now you're going to have to kick it right back to the Bears. And Reggie Miller is back deep, and I'll tell you what, he's with Malcolm Frank, but Miller is awfully dangerous. A freshman out of Waco, he played on the same high school team with Anthony Williams.
I would guess, Bill, that Baylor should come out of this with very good field position. The ball kicked from the 20 into that 25, 26 mile an hour wind.
Some people say, well, why do you kick it off the tee? I think against that wind, it's better than punting it, isn't it?
Yeah, because if you kick the low line drive, they're going to catch it on the run, and he's probably maybe going to squib kick this one. I don't know. I don't know how strong his leg is. No, he kicked it straight through.
Normally at home, the Aggies would have the 12th man kickoff unit, but not on the road. And it goes to Malcolm Frank, reverses, got running room. He's at the 40. Brought down at the 44-yard line. A run of about 22 yards for Malcolm Frank before he's brought down by Deion Snow for A&M.
Bill, I tell you, everybody talks about momentum in all these ball games, but right now, old Mo's over on this sideline. You can really feel it. And the Baylor players are encouraging the Baylor fans to get involved, and A&M's got to do something to break this momentum right now.
Well, Bobby Jack Goforth has just checked into the game along with David Frost. What a story he is, and we'll get a shot of him in a moment. He wears number 7. He's the senior out of Caldwell. They call him the comeback kid, and he'll be split to the top of your screen. Leading receiver, he caught 2 touchdown passes against the Aggies last year. Here comes a fake reverse. Gable, a receiver wide open at the 40-yard line. Eric Gilstrap dropped the ball. He could have gone for 6.
Yeah, your first reaction is you want to choke him to death, but he didn't drop it on purpose. It was one of those deals.
Great play, and that enabled Thomas to go after the other man and left Gable wide open. Good gracious, he was looking at Horton, and he never saw the football all the way in.
Well, that sometimes is a beauty of making your living with young people.
Yeah.
Those things happen.
They used Goforth to clear out the cornerback. Same alignment by Baylor. This time they'll hand it off to Raphael, and he scoots to about midfield before he's brought down by James Webb. So we're seeing James Webb a lot in place of Aaron Wallace. So Wallace suffering from a turf toe and a strep throat.
If no one has ever experienced a turf toe, you just can't imagine how painful that really is. Most people think, well, that's not that disabling, but it's very painful.
Well, James is the little Webb. He weighs only 225. His brother, Richmond Webb, big brother, is 6'6", 291. Third down, Baylor needs 6. Gable across the middle. It's complete at the A&M 42-yard line. Great reception, and it looks like it's going to be Reggie Miller. It is, the young freshman out of Waco. He really got a sandwich job, but he held on to the ball.
Great concentration, Bill. That's all that you talk to your receivers about, distraction and concentrating on the point of the football. And that young man, that's just great concentration. That guy's arm is in there, the backers. Beautiful job.
Well, that was just all he could see were ones. Number 11, William Thomas, and Mickey Washington, number one, did the sandwich job. But Miller was a defensive back in his redshirt year last year, but they switched him to offense. It's paid off. Rafael right side. Gain of about two. Pat Henry, along with Terry Price over there.
Bill, I had a chance to meet Pat Henry when he was coming out of high school at Silsbee. What a nice, class young man he is. I had a chance to visit with him a couple of different times. Very, very, just to handle himself very well.
And you know, Ray, Henry is a freshman, and so is Kevin Tucker, a freshman out of Angleton, number 90, who was also in on the play. And
that's two good freshmen.
Boy, I'll tell you, when you can put two freshmen down there in the Southwest Conference, that's saying something for their ability. Second down, Gable needs nine. Was it intercepted? Almost. It was knocked away at the 35. It was intended for Bobby Jack Goforth. Kevin Smith really did a good job.
Number 26.
He's from your neck of the woods.
Right.
He's
an orange fella. And I tell you what, Kevin, when he came out of high school, was a guy that people felt like had been an offensive or defensive player and been impactful on both sides of the football. He's done a great job at Texas A&M. I think he's our leading interceptor at this point with three.
Boy, there have been so many great college players come out of the Golden Triangle area. As you see the stats on Brad Gable, third down. This is an awfully big play for the A&M defense with 4:53 left to play in the first quarter. Baylor leading 5-0.
Got offside.
Somebody jumped offside for the Aggies. Gable has a free play, and he goes to Goforth. It's over his head. Aggies had the rush on, and they jumped offsides. I think it may have been William Thomas.
Go from third to nine to third and four now. And that's, you know, it could be a big play. Trying to get a little bit of an edge.
Defense, 5-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Well, now you've also done another thing. You have moved Jeff Ireland into field goal range, so even if Baylor can't convert on this third down play, Ireland would be able to attempt another field goal.
You're talking about a 54-yarder from this spot right here, which with this win certainly is achievable.
Only one running back behind Gable. Again, almost offsides A&M, but he got back.
Blitz, Bill.
Yeah, big blitz. Next. Washington, and
big
he
play.
Takes him right out of field goal range. Mickey Washington.
That's another Golden Triangle fella there from Beaumont Westbrook. That's a good call by the Aggie defense, getting him out of field goal range.
Now, you don't have to tell Andre Ware anything about this. He saw it all day long last week.
Right. That's a great call by the A&M defensive coaches. Had a twist up front and brought both outside corners.
Pete Rutter is averaging 44 yards a punt. He's the best punter they've had here at Baylor since Buzzy Sawyer. And he's angling it out of bounds, and it almost got out of bounds. It went into the end zone, however. He was going for the Kauffman corner, and it just missed. So the Aggies will have the ball when we return in a moment. 4:03 left to play in the first period. So far, it's been all Baylor. 5-0.
At Lexus, we didn't just suppress the engine noise.
Please see your professional soon.
Well, the Aggies now with Pavlis will be setting up the offense for Texas A&M at the Aggie 20-yard line. And the Aggies have been pinned back in their own territory for most of the first period with 4 minutes left to play in this quarter.
Yeah, that's a really, really big series for the Aggie defense. That, as we mentioned, took them out of field goal range.
Aaron Lewis, big run over right guard. Gary Joe Kinney made the tackle. Good blocks by Mike Arthur, Darren Groot, and Mac McCall on the right side for the Aggies.
You know, Matt's been big all his life. I remember when he came out of high school watching him on film. He was a giant then.
6'8", 314 pounds, a junior out of Lufkin.
He's a little heavier than he was. They feed him pretty good up there at College Station.
Well, the problem for the Aggies, they've only managed one first down, and that came on a penalty. I formation. Again, Lewis, he's got the first down and then some. Across the 30 to the 32, James Francis made the tackle.
Well, it looks as if the Texas A&M has made up their mind. They're going to hammer the ball at him a little bit and try to run the clock out into the half, into the win, in the first quarter.
Well, not a bad decision. I'm kind of surprised that we haven't seen Robert Wilson carry the ball. He's had such an excellent year so far. But it's been all Darren Lewis for A&M.
There it is right there.
There's Wilson across the 35 to the 36.
That was a nice job of carrying the ball. He cut back behind the block of the center and the right guard.
John Godfrey made the tackle, 250-pound junior out of Dallas, South Oak Cliff. Brad Gable talking to one of the coaches up in the booth. For the next time Baylor gets their hands on the ball, fumble, Baylor has it. At the 36-yard line, big play man again, James Francis.
Yes. I think that the guard may have knocked the ball out of his hands as he pulled right there. Look and see if that isn't what happened.
All right, let's watch it again. There's
no.
He just never got the snap.
He never got out there with the football.
Arthur and Lance Pavlis never got together, and James Francis made the recovery. So Francis with a fumble recovery and a blocked punt already in the first quarter of this game. 2:38 left to play, and Baylor with excellent field position now. Elwin Raphael. Big running room at the 26-yard line before he's brought down on the play by Kevin Smith and Gary Jones.
Bill, he started that to his left and then broke it all the way backside. Seems coming over this way. Now watch him break it backside. Good job of Baylor of cutting off the backside pursuit.
Now, Raphael, a junior out of Lawton, Oklahoma, he has rushed for 24 yards already here in the first quarter. Came into the game averaging about 5 yards per carry. Second down, Baylor needs one. Gable's going to go for all of it, and he overthrows his wide-open receiver, Reggie Miller, at about the 12-yard line. Mickey Washington was right there with him.
A nice call by the Baylor coaches, a little play action on second and one. A&M was headed well defense, though. There wasn't much room to throw the football in there.
That's a good coaching staff. Cotton Davidson, F.A. Dry, Pete Fredenberg, John Goodner, Robert James. We got a good coaching staff there.
I talked to F.A.&M a minute ago and told them just a game, not to worry about it. It'll be all right.
Oh, sure. This isn't your team.
You're right.
Oh, big hole. Could go.
That's
a
great
run cut by Lincoln Coleman. First down, Baylor at the A&M 13-yard line. Lincoln Coleman started inside and cut it back to the outside.
Dip in, dip out. That's just good ball carrying right here.
Boy, also a good block by Eric Gilstrap on the play. And the backfield got him cleared.
Everything was kind of compressed down inside because of Ben. That is a nice block by Gilstrap.
That time he was using Murray, Gilstrap, and Coleman, all three in the backfield. Tight formation for the Bears. Hand off, Lincoln Coleman, left side. This time, not much running room.
Lincoln Coleman.
It's a little sticky down there.
We're fixing to have a little trouble here if those officials don't grab a hold of this. There's a little pushing and shoving going on. Pretty good intensity level.
18th year for that man, Grant Taft. Only Bo Schembechler and Joe Paterno have served their schools any longer than Grant has. 6 times Southwest Conference Coach of the Year, 1 time, and that was the miracle on the Brazos. In 1974, he was the National Coach of the Year. Second down, needing 8. good penetration in the backfield by one of the Aggies. It looked like it was Gary Jones, the senior out of Tyler. He got a lot of penetration and was able to trip Coleman up for a loss of about five.
Bill, for some reason, I think Baylor is coming to their left or to Texas A&M's right. Either they feel that's their strength or A&M's weakness.
Well, of course, you've got James Webb over there. With Aaron Wallace not in the lineup, they may want to pick on Webb. Well, we'll see with third down needing 10.
A&M better get lined up. Okay, they led the tight end. Was uncovered here.
12 seconds left to play in the first quarter. It looked like somebody jumped off sides. No play. Now, somebody may have jumped for Baylor. We'll wait and see. Might have been Pat Henry. For A&M, the nose guard may have been offsides. I think that's the call. Henry jumped a little soon.
Offside. Defense. Repeat, third down.
Gable changed his cadence.
You know, you work with defensive linemen, watch the football move, but sometimes it's just human nature. You listen to that inflection of that quarterback.
Yeah, I don't want to give Pat Henry a bum rap there. It was John Miller, the junior, backup, just about over with the quarter now. This could be the last play with 6 seconds remaining to play. Gable, big rush by the Aggies and a sack in the backfield by Trent Lewis. The freshman out of Huntsville. A&M brought a lot of people.
Yeah, when you go all out blitz like that, you put a lot of pressure on your secondary, but they've been successful with it.
Last week against Houston, they didn't use a lot of down linemen. They used mostly defensive backs and linebackers. It was a loss on the play by Baylor. It's the end of the first quarter, and when we come back, the Bears will be attempting another field goal after the end of one period of play. From Floyd Casey Stadium, it's Baylor 5, Texas A&M nothing. He also recovered a fumble. Baylor will try to convert that here with a field goal. And already one Jeff Ireland field goal on the first drive of the game. So it's been a Baylor-dominated football game up to now.
Yeah, I think the wind has had a little bit to do with that. But Baylor has just played very well up to this point, Bill. I would be a little concerned here with the kicker. I know he's an experienced player, but the wind is a little bit out of the west as well. And if you are particularly with a soccer-style guy, if you draw it right to left, as most of them do, you could push it off to his left.
Well, these two kickers are veterans. Ireland, with his field goal today, is now 9 of 12. He's perfect for extra points, so he has 41 points on the season. Lane Talbot has 42 for the Aggies. Now they're going to spot it down at about the 18-yard line, so it'll be a 28-yard attempt. Jeff Ireland, you watch it. Perfect.
Right down the middle.
So Baylor has had the football four possessions and has scored on three. 14-57 as we're just underway with the second quarter, and Baylor leads it now 8-0 over the Aggies. And I'll tell you what, Ray, so far Baylor has forced things to happen.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, old Mo kind of shifted a little bit, and then they had the fumble.
R.C. Slocum on the sideline, the assistant at A&M for 16 of the last 17 years. He went out to sunny California for 1 year, the defensive coordinator at USC in 1981, but he said, hey, that wasn't my cup of tea.
Oh, R.C.'s from Orange, and I just can't imagine him out in L.A. There's something about that. But I tell you, I am so proud for R.C. because you always like to see assistant coaches and guys do a good job. And I'm really, really proud for him, and he's getting this opportunity to be the head football coach because I think he deserves it.
Well, we'd like to remind you, join us tomorrow night at 6 for the Texas High School Football Game of the Week. This week, our HSE cameras travel to the Texas Gulf Coast for a 26-5A battle between the Victoria Stingarees and the Corpus Christi Carroll Tigers. So watch the stars of tomorrow compete right here today on HSE, the best team on TV. It has been a game for homers between these two teams. Baylor has lost all three on the road. Baylor has lost to Oklahoma, Georgia, and Houston. Of course, that's pretty tough company.
It's three pretty good football teams.
But here at Floyd Casey Stadium, Baylor has outscored the opposition 75-18. So the Bears are awfully tough.
That could be trouble right there.
Well, it's a fair catch. Good heads-up play.
There's a penalty.
And there's a penalty. Ought to be a flag.
Yeah.
They ran into the kicker. He signaled for a fair catch, and I don't see a flag anywhere on the play.
Sure should be.
Trooper Taylor was down there early, and that was a heads-up play by the Aggies.
Very, very smart play. It's an example of a well-coached football team.
Yeah, he gave a signal, and then there was contact, but there was no flag.
He went to a knee, and they may have decided that was the reason not to call it, but it looked like it should have been a penalty to me. But I think that all the time anyway.
Now the Aggies have the win for the next 14-56. Baylor got 8 points with that 20-mile-per-hour wind to its back. Lewis, right tackle, large running room, a gain of about 7 across the 35-yard line. James Francis wrapped him up.
I tell you, I think Texas A&M's offensive line is really beginning to come off the football and establishing a new line of scrimmage, and I would anticipate they're going to continue to hammer the football up in there. They're making good yardage, but just don't turn it over.
Well, with that run, Lewis has passed Bubba Bean to move to third on the all-time A&M rushing list. Robert Wilson is the runner this time, and I think he has enough for the first down. Darren Franklin made the tackle for Baylor. Wilson got off to a great start this year. He had 115 yards rushing against the University of Houston. He has 430 on the season. Every time he touches a ball, he averages about 72 yards a game rushing.
He's a big load when you hand it to him in there, getting a good head of steam.
245 pounds.
About your weight. About my weight.
And he can run a lot faster.
Well, yeah, that's debatable. In the old days.
Lance Pavlos really having a good year this year. And the Aggies are so well balanced. They've been able to throw for almost the same amount of yardage as they've rushed it this year. So it's hard to defense them. First down and 10 A&M. And it looked like Darren Groot moved. He did. It'll be a 5-yard penalty.
Those are the things that really drive you crazy. The little penalty. You get a little something going, and then you have a mistake like that. And guys don't do that intentionally.
You know, you talked about in the open.
First down.
You talked in the open about RC maybe worried about the intensity of the Aggies, and it looks like maybe their concentration isn't as good as it was last week.
Well, you often, as a coach, you always say when something like that happens, that you've got to concentrate on every snap of what your assignment is. You know, he may not have heard the snap or whatever, but it really drives you crazy as a coach. Here comes blitz.
They picked it up. Pavlos going long. He's got Waddle long, and he overthrows him at the 15-yard line. Percy Waddle, the intended receiver, Charles Bell, was with him just about step to step.
Oh, Percy can really run, Bill. He has really got great speed.
Yeah, he's got 20 catches on the year for Texas A&M. Had a good game against Houston last week. He was open for just a moment.
Tough catch over your head, over your shoulder, running away from the football like that.
Well, we haven't seen Pavlos go to Mike Jones, his big tight end. He might this time, second down, needing 15. Pavlos going to Patterson instead, and he gets to only about the 32-yard line. Mikey Smith made a good tackle.
Yeah, you're not going to be able to run east and west against the Southwest Conference against the speed of all these people on defense. You've got to get the ball headed up north-south. Must have been a face mask penalty, Bill.
Well, there was a play to Cornelius Patterson. You'll have to see what the call is.
There was a screen. He was in a slot. It was a screen to him. Looked like at first it had great potential, but as I said, he was too much lateral in the pursuit, caught up with it.
Inadvertently grabbed is the face mask by the defense. 5-yard penalty, repeat, second down.
It was an accident. That's what that means. Sometimes it's hard. Whoa.
Yeah.
sometimes it's hard to not grab the face mask because they have so many different face masks now that stick way out.
Well, then you get your hand around that helmet area, you're taking a chance.
So now it's second down. The Aggies need 10 rather than 15. High formation for A&M. Option play. Pavlis pitches out to Lewis. Great play. Did he get to the 49-yard line? It'll be close. Frankie Smith ran him out of bounds. But Pavlis is a super athlete. He runs this very well.
This could be a forward lateral here, Bill. The line of scrimmage.
Well, if it's behind the line of scrimmage, it's a forward pass.
Yeah. But if it's across the line of scrimmage, it's a forward pass, and that's illegal. Or as Peterson would say, illogical. And that looked like it was across the line of scrimmage.
Well, it was close.
But it wasn't called. So
it will bring up third needing one for A&M. Big down. They'll give it to their big money man, Lewis, across the middle. He's got the first down and then some. Robert Wilson, I should say, not Lewis. James Francis brought him down. Wilson busted one against the University of Houston, similar to this last week.
That's just a power lead play. Great blocking by their front people and good ball carrying. Got his shoulder pads down, protected the football, lowered his head and got the first down. It's fixing to get tight here in just a minute, William.
Out of Worthing High School, the Aggies with a nice drive. That wind has been an important ally today for both offenses. Lewis now, right. Oh, my goodness, Gary Joe Kinney was there to meet him.
Counter sweep and great job. He steps up and makes a play. Comes forward. They may have had man coverage on the tailback.
Gary Joe Kinney already is well on his way. He's going for 130 tackles this season. That would tie Mike Singletary, who did it three times in a row for the Bears.
Well, Mike was never very intense.
And you're just kidding,
of course. Yeah, right.
Pavlis across the middle. He's got the completion at the 35-yard line to Cornelius Patterson. Curtis Hafford made the tackle for Baylor. Well, he's really whipped that one in.
Yeah, he stepped up in there and delivered that football on the line. That was a nice throw and a nice catch. Baylor's three linebackers are all three very, very outstanding football players.
Third down, needing three. Texas A&M. Look for the quick pass. It wasn't there. Baylor now in a lot of pursuit. Where's Pavlis going to go long? He had a receiver. Patterson, did he have it in bounds? I don't know. No, he was out of bounds, incomplete. The Aggies are really arguing.
The college rule, which I don't agree with, is he has got to get the foot down. If he gets knocked out, it's incomplete.
Well, he was looking left at first. Now watch Charles Bell. He's the key player here, number 22 for Baylor, as he's going to push him out. Oh, Ray.
Uh-oh.
I don't know.
Well, he's only got to get one down.
Well, does he have possession of the ball now? That's a key, too.
Yeah, and that's hard to tell on there, but it looked like he did.
Well, and also, even if he didn't, he was carried out of bounds.
Yeah. But see, that makes no difference in college football, Bill. It's not like the pros.
This will be a 52-yard attempt by Talbot. It looked like the holder had trouble getting hold of the ball. It'll be wide to the left. No good. And the Baylor Bears hold. It looked to me like the holder never got control of the football. And we'll take a break. 11:26 left to play in the second quarter. And the Baylor Bears are shutting out the Aggies 8-0.
Experience the entertainment, talent, and emotion of the 1990 Mobile Cotton Bowl Classic. Go for it. Order your tickets today.
What do you have?
Give me two pizza pops, chili dog.
Excuse me. Gus.
1 minute.
Sorry.
Give me two pizza pups, a chili dog, a large...
Nick! Norm!
Gus, I told you, to be hot dog kings, we need lots of Bud Light.
Not Bob Light?
If you want the one light that outshines them all, ask for Bud Light.
Now what do you think? It's beautiful.
Because everything else is just a light.
Hey, what about my pizza puffs?
I'm Bill Keyes of Tapatio Springs. As a Southern Texas golf professional, one of my jobs is to help your group plan its next golf outing. See your Southern Texas pro.
Brad Gable will set up the offense for Baylor at the Baylor 35-yard line. Pitch back, Raphael, left side, got a couple.
Bill, I want you to, we can get a replay on this. Watch 72 at 330 pounds. Watch him pull and come around the corner and get a block. That is unbelievable. That guy, that was a great play by that big fella at 330 pounds.
Yeah, John Turnpaugh weighs 330 out of Aldine Nimitz, but he also is a very nimble 330, if you can be. He moves those legs very well.
That was unbelievable there, the way he got out in front.
Raphael is the lone setback. Gilstrap is the wing back. Bobby Jack Goforth is also in there. Gilstrap comes in motion. They're going to hand it to Raphael right side. Gilstrap got a good block to clear him out to the 43-yard line. Larry Horton knocked him out of bounds.
Raphael must may be hurt right there. I think he got a helmet right above the kidney.
All right, we'll get a better view of the play here. Horton gets him right there. Oh, there's the helmet right there. Mm-hmm. Right in the back.
Ooh.
Lewis got a shot from one of the Cougars in last week's game similar to that, and he was really hurting the entire game for the Aggies. Kevin Smith was also in there.
Has excellent job of carrying the football, a good block by Gilstrap out in front. They've gotten some mileage out of that play in the first half.
Well, you see, Raphael just a little under his average of 5 yards per carry for this game. But it was a nice gain, and it gives Baylor 1 yard now needed for the first down. Third and one, the ball at the 43-yard line. Lincoln Coleman, Gilstrap in the backfield. Coleman, first down.
I've been impressed with him, the little he's carried the football. He has good body lean and seems to have good foot quickness to change directions.
Anthony Williams got to him along with Patrick Henry, but it was a little too late. And Lincoln Coleman now beginning to get a lot more action since the start of the season. He's carried five times now for 20 yards. The stats on Lincoln Coleman, first down and 10 Baylor. About 3 yards needed to get into A&M territory. Murray in motion. He'll set a block. And it'll be Lincoln Coleman again running right side. Anthony Williams again the tackler.
We've got a little scrap down here on the sidelines, kind of on the Baylor bench.
Lincoln Coleman took the pitch. Larry Horton and Anthony Williams.
They weren't even near the play. Anthony Williams.
Bill Baylor has been in two tight ends now with one wide receiver. Two plays in a row, you wonder if they're maybe not going to line up and try to hammer a little bit themselves and maintain possession of the ball into the wind.
Yards rushing so far, but both teams fairly close. Motion goes Jeffrey Murray, and Lincoln Coleman will get the football. Fumble! Steve Stutzman saved the day.
Well, I see Raphael's up over here on the sideline. I would imagine he'll be ready to go here in just a second.
Number 11, William Thomas.
Well, you know, there were white jerseys everywhere, and Stutzman came out of the pile to get the football. There's the strip job right there by William Thomas.
It's an excellent play by Stutzman to keep maintain possession of the football.
And now it brings up third down. Baylor needs three. 8:33 left to play. Second period. Baylor leading at 8-0. Coleman's been the workhorse. Nothing there, however. Big rush by the Aggies, led by William Thomas. Thomas, an interesting story. Ray, he was a cornerback, and then they put him at safety. They thought he was a little too slow to play there, so they moved him to linebacker, and he wasn't even first team in the spring drill.
Bill, the guy I remember was a high school quarterback, Johnny Holland at Hempstead. Remember him? He was small, undersized, and came in. What a great linebacker he turned out to be for Texas A&M. And Thomas is much in that same mold.
Well, there was a flag right at the point of the ball, right at the end of the play. And they're going to mark it off against the Aggies.
Grasping the face mask by the defense. That'll be a 5-yard penalty. It'll be a first down by yardage.
Couldn't call it any better than Wendell Shelton as we see if we can see the face mask.
There it is right there.
Looked like Patrick Henry may have gotten his right hand full.
Sort of an inadvertent.
Well, boy, that really makes it tough on the Aggies as their third penalty of the game because it gives Baylor a first down in A&M territory at the Aggie 41-yard line.
Here comes Blitz, and they call the right shot.
Lincoln Coleman, boy, good job of running. He got an extra couple.
Lincoln Coleman. And
somebody put a heck of a block on Gary Jones.
Yeah, they were bringing Gary Jones, and the fullback picked him up.
And it looks like Jeffrey Murray is down now, and he really looks hurt. The senior out of Sterling in Houston. Maybe just got the wind knocked out of him, we hope so. Yeah, he's a tough one, though, isn't he? 5'10", 217 pounds.
He may have got one of those long-distance calls you get every now and then in this game, you know, where you just kind of, you're all fuzzy and you're not sure where you are, and it'll all come back to you in a few minutes.
Well, he, you know, in the Baylor scheme of things, the running back will run the ball almost every down, and the fullback will catch the ball. Murray, the leading receiver for Baylor. Second down and 7 now for the Bears. Ball on the A&M 38-yard line. 7:45 left to play second quarter.
Here comes a strong safety again.
Here comes an audible, too, by Gable. He saw the blitz coming. He'll audible to the pass play. He's got a man open, and a great defensive play, and they're going to call face guarding against the Aggies, I believe, on Kevin Smith. The ball was intended for Reggie Miller. Smith knocked it away, but did he go after the ball? And the referee says no, he didn't.
That's a pretty tough call there, Bill. I'd like to look at it again on the replay. I think he just turns and goes up.
Well, it hit him on the helmet, didn't it?
You know, you tell the guy when his hands go up, that's when you go up.
Highest interference, defense.
Like a pretty good play to me, right?
Yeah. The only thing that they may have called was his hands pushed into him as he went up to catch the football.
Well, as you know, well, R.C. Slocum, of course, isn't going to like it, but it's a 15-yard penalty.
Bill, Baylor continues to go with two tight ends and one wide receiver. I would look for in a minute to come off some play action and try to hit him for the big chunk.
Well, as you noticed, when Gable threw that ball, it went into that 26-mile-per-hour wind. It looked like somebody had shot it with a gun. It's tough to throw into that breeze, but it's first and 10 Baylor on the A&M 24-yard line. Baylor already leading 8-0. Look for the reverse. There it is. Does he have a block? Yes, he does. It was Miller, Reggie Miller, and he tried to turn the corner at the 20-yard line. Kevin Smith, what a great job of staying at home.
Hey, that not only that, but what a great farm tackle. This is the way you draw it up. Hit with the helmet, neck up, locked in, club your arms up. Great job. Great judgment by one of the Baylor players and not clipping right here.
Oh, what a block by Turnpaw. He caught somebody and blindsided him.
Oh, what a nice, that's farm tackle there, buddy.
Oh, Alonzo Pierce would have had to have clipped.
Yeah, right. Great judgment on his part to pass that up.
Yeah, because that would have been a costly penalty. It's second down and 6 for Baylor. The ball at the A&M 20-yard line. Blitz coming by A&M. Gable. He has a receiver at the 15-yard line, Reggie Miller, and I don't know whether he has enough for the first down. We'll see.
I believe he's about a half yard short, Bill, but as you can see now, the Aggies are beginning to really bring the heat on him.
Of course, the Baylor Bears were hurting last year in two-a-days when Bobby Jack Goforth went out with a leg injury last year, and of course, they a little thin at wide receiver. Well, they moved Reggie Miller into that slot. Brent Taft very happy with the job he has done. Third down, needing one. Lincoln Coleman. Well, he danced east to west, and finally, he went south.
I'm sorry, Lincoln. You go east, west, and then north-south. When you've got that kind of talent, the coach better stay out of it. Just let him play.
Terry Price, Kevin Tucker making the tackle for A&M, but it's enough for a Baylor first down. The Bears can make a first down at the two-yard line.
Bill, the really important thing about this is that Baylor has maintained possession of the football into the wind for a very good period of time.
Miles and Goforth, the wide receivers at the lower part of your screen for Baylor. Going to throw it to Murray. Screen play. Got inside the 10 to about the 9-yard line. Anthony Williams saved the day for the Aggies because it looked like for just a moment Murray had daylight.
I think one of the most difficult plays to execute, it seems, is a screen pass because you get all the big linemen out there and they can't make they don't know who to block. You know, they end up two guys go to one and the other guy makes a play.
And Ray, I think Baylor's done a good job of recognizing, Gable at least, recognizing that blitz when the Aggies bring it.
No doubt. A minute ago with the two tight ends, he checked to the play where they got the pass interference call.
Ball at the 10-yard line. Gable into the end zone. Almost intercepted by Mickey Washington. Oh, he may have gone 100 yards with that ball.
That was a great break on the football. I don't know. He reaches with one hand. I don't know what causes him to just reach one. That's a great break on the ball, though.
Intended for Goforth, Bobby Jack.
And a little bit outside.
Yeah, if Mickey gets that one, he's long gone. Senior out of Beaumont.
Wish we could have kept him in Beaumont, I'll tell you. He's a good football player.
Third down. They need 8 for a first, 10 for a touch.
Here comes blitz, Bill.
Murray's in motion for Baylor. Gable, fumble, and the Aggies have it. At the 12-yard line, William Thomas, the big play man for A&M.
You need to make a note of that play right there, Bill. That could be really, really a big play in a football game. Baylor's at least within field goal range. And now A&M's got the football.
Boy, what a play by Gary Jones from his strong safety position. Watch number 6 from the left side. Oh, Gable never saw him. And then William Thomas wrapped it up.
That could be a big one in the football game.
First down and 10 for the Aggies at the 12-yard line. 4:50 left to play in the second period. And a handoff to Wilson. And he only gets a couple.
Marcus Lowe is a transfer from the University of Oklahoma from Northbrook High School in Houston. Heavily, heavily recruited, went to Oklahoma, and for whatever reason decided not to stay and came to Baylor, and boy, he's going to be a great football player for him.
High formation, Aggies, Darren Lewis, right side, trying to bounce out, find a hole, and there wasn't much there. Robert Blackman really put the hit on him.
Robert Blackman was the stop.
Tell you, with Blackman and Mike Welch, that's a very physical secondary for Baylor. And you know what? Grant's always recruited good defensive backs here at Baylor.
You know, they have good defensive backs. They're known for the linebackers and running backs. Dennis Gentry, Walter Abercrombie in the same football team. And then, of course, Cody Carson, quarterback of the owner.
Yep. And he has the career passing record here at Baylor. Third down, the Aggies need 6. Try to keep the drive alive. Pavlos across the middle. There's his big tight. Jones, he fumbles the ball. Who's going to get it? Big race is on. Baylor has the football. Robert Blackman ran it down. Well, I wondered where Mike Jones had been. He came 22 catches today. Pavlis found Jones wide open. He had the first down. He tried to get more and lost the football.
That was a great job by the backer coming in from behind him and stripping the football away from him. Pavlis had plenty of time. Baylor had a twist on. They picked it up and did a good job there. And it was a nice catch by Jones.
Curtis Hafford was the man who put the helmet on the ball. And now it was just who was going to run it down. Blackman.
Great effort to get to the ball. And the old momentum has swung again, William.
Well, the Aggies are making too many mistakes today. And, Ray, this is not the same A&M team that I watched last weekend.
And it goes back again to what we talked about, maybe the intensity level.
They were sky high for the University of Houston and look a little flat today here in Waco.
One of the things that Baylor must ensure right now is they get down and at least get the opportunity to get 3 points and get a big lift going into the dressing room.
Raphael got about three. John Miller made the tackle along with Terry Price for the Aggies. So the ball at the 35-yard line. 3:10 left to play in the second quarter. Steve Stutzman checks in for Baylor. He has a 65-yard touchdown reception this year. Stutzman is an excellent receiver also, and he has not been thrown to so far in this game. Second down and 8. Brad Gable.
William Thomas is fixing to come screaming down here at the bottom.
He read it, and it was almost intercepted by Jeroy Robinson. Good job of anticipation. It was intended for Stutzman.
Right.
He saw the, as you said, the blitz coming, and Robinson got the big mitt up, the senior out of Bryan. 6'2", 240 pounds.
It's getting to the point anymore, Bill, where a linebacker can hardly play college football unless he's 240.
Well, unless you're William Thomas. Gable is 5'11", 5 out of 11 for 44 yards. Third down, he needs 8. Again, a big rush by A&M. Gable directing traffic, but he doesn't have time as Mickey Washington came in a rush.
All-out blitz again, Bill, and Brad Gable has got to unload the football right there in that situation.
Loss of 11 on the play, and watch Washington close. The Aggies have probably as quick a defense as anybody in the country.
He didn't come on the blitz. He just comes when they lose containment, but Gable has got to somehow unload that football and save the sack in the 11-yard loss.
One thing the Aggies have been able to do all season is force turnovers. Coming into this game, the Aggies had forced 20 turnovers in 6 games. That's a pretty good ratio.
Darn right. And I tell you, what you said is very obvious. They have great team speed on defense. They've got a lot of guys that can run.
Mickey Washington is back. Rudder kicks it low into the wind and trying to get it to die at the 1. It goes into the end zone. So Baylor will have the football at the 20-yard line. 1:45, or I should say A&M will have the ball at the 20 when we come back. 8-0 Baylor with 1:45 left to play in the first half.
To unlock your body's potential, we proudly offer Soloflex. 24 old-fashioned iron-pumping exercises, each correct in form and balance. All on the simple machine that fits in the corner of your home. For a free brochure, call anytime.
If you're a fitness enthusiast, don't miss The Weight Room, a weekly half-hour television program produced specifically for you. Each week, we examine how world-class athletes prepare for competition. We demonstrate specific weight training techniques used by the experts and discuss diet, exercise, fitness, and nutrition. We also examine the future of fitness and sports medicine, all right here on The Weight Room. Tune us in each week.
Well, it's been the defense of Baylor so far, shutting out Texas A&M 8-0. The Aggies now have 1:45 to try to get some points on the board. Pavlis trips right. 3 wide receivers. He's got plenty of time, and now he goes across the middle to Wilson. 35, and he's dragged down from behind. Could be a face mask by James Francis. But
Robert Wilson got 15, and they may get 15 more.
And the worst thing that can happen to Baylor at this point is to give them easy yardage.
Boy, you know, Ray, though, Francis weighs 248, and he ran Wilson down from behind almost.
And he closed the ground
in the
face,
sure man. Did.
This was not, of course, his initial receiver.
No, a four-man rush. He stepped up and delivered the ball to Wilson. And watch Francis close on him.
Yeah, but he doesn't get him if he doesn't get that face mask.
Right. He doesn't reach.
Ball at the 42-yard line. First down. Pavlis looking to go long. It's intended for Waddle. He's open. No, and it's just through his arms in the end zone. Malcolm Frank may have reached up at the last second to deflect that ball, but Percy Waddle had it all the way.
You know, that is an excellent throw by Pavlis. Bill, with the wind behind you blowing 20 miles an hour plus, that's hard to gauge it and throw the ball like that. And it's a nice effort by Percy. Well, hit him up on the pad, it looked like. I'm sure the hand maybe got in the way, Malcolm Frank's hand.
Yeah, that was a good job. They tried to double team him. He's second down. Little play action by Pavlis rolling right. Pavlis going deep. Big tight end off the fingers of Mike Jones.
Same play they opened the game with, and Jones was open, but he carried himself much further across the field. Didn't have a whole lot of room to work with on the sideline there, and I'm sure that caused Pavlis to sky the ball.
Is the play selection in the huddle, is that Jones get open?
No, that's just boot.
But, well, I mean, it looked like.
Yeah,
you know,
but on the first play of the game, he's open. But Pavlis got a little bit of pressure and couldn't see him. But then, of course, he was in front of him all the way. He didn't have much sideline to work with.
5 of 13 for Pavlis on the day. A big third down for the Aggies with 1:12 left to play. He might get a free play, and the whistle's blue. I don't know if Reggie Howard jumped offside or not.
That's a smart play by the center. When a guy gets in the neutral zone, you pop the ball up, you got an easy five, and you go back to the huddle and get it again. And sometimes it's hard to get executed. And then every once in a while, they don't call it. But your quarterback's got to have his hands ready, and you get an easy 5 yards if you're center of season.
Offside defense, 5 yard penalty, third down.
Well, Mike Arthur is one of the veterans, a junior out of Spring Woods.
Yep. That's good, smart football there.
Notice Pavlis was looking off to his left. He wasn't even ready for it. Third down, needing five. Pavlis, Baylor, big rush. Pavlis can't get out of the pocket.
Bill, James Francis didn't make the play, but he flushed. The back butts him and doesn't block him, and he panics. Pavlis flushes him and causes a play. He did not make the tackle, but made the play.
Yerrick Long made the tackle, but you're right. James Francis was a load on the play. He forced it. And Baylor now will call a timeout. With 54 seconds left to play. So the Bears feel like if they can force A&M to punt, they can possibly get on the field goal, at least get in the field goal range before the half. We'll be looking at the Baylor band at halftime, by the way. Also, we'll be visiting with Athletic Director Bill Minnemy.
...on either side of the stadium. And be a part of the...
We remind you that great NBA action returns to HSE in November. In the Summit, Akeem Olajuwon, Otis Thorpe lead the Rockets. In Dallas, veteran guards Roe Blackman and Derek Harper fill it up from the outside for the Mavs. And in San Antonio, the long wait is over for David Robinson's coming out party. Great NBA action beginning in November, right here on HSE. Well, last night in Reunion Arena, Robinson made a field goal with about a minute to go. San Antonio defeated Dallas in a preseason game.
We've got a Lamar guy trying to make the rocket ball throw, Adrian Caldwell.
Yeah, he's playing very good too, Ray.
Well, I tried to get him to come out for football.
He's big enough.
Oh, yeah, he's been a great defensive lineman.
John Wilson, can he kill it at the one? Nope. Touchback. Went into the end zone. That was a great punt by Wilson. The Aggies were trying to get him back inside the five. Here's where you'd just like to kill it right here.
I would not think that Baylor is going to do anything exotic right at this stage of the game.
Well, I wouldn't with 43 seconds. And owning an 8-0 lead.
Oh, Sean Wilson has great genes, doesn't he, Bill?
Oh, boy. Huh? Gerald
as
Wilson,
far as a kicker is concerned.
Gerald Wilson may have been the best I ever saw.
Yeah, I saw him when we were training up in Huntsville. He came by a couple times and visited, and I bet he can still kick that darn thing 40.
Timeout.
Well, so now the Aggies call a timeout. So what A&M would like to do maybe is hold Baylor and force a punt into that win.
I don't understand why they called one now, though. The clock was stopped. Unless they had some personnel problems, maybe they didn't have the right people on the field for what they anticipated Baylor doing.
So both teams now have two timeouts left in the first half. This telecast is authorized under rights granted to Home Sports Entertainment and is not intended for the commercial use of our viewing audience. Any reproduction or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Home Sports Entertainment and Baylor University is prohibited. So for Baylor, it's been a couple of field goals by Jeff Ireland and a safety on a blocked punt by James Francis. And that's been all the offense we've had. The Aggies have just not been able to generate anything today. Gable will have Raphael and Murray in the backfield. And he'll give it to Raphael, right guard.
Two tight ends. They're going to just try to hammer it and run the clock out. I would imagine the Aggies will use their timeout after the next down if they don't make the first down.
...21 seconds left to play. Apparently they're going to let it run out.
I would imagine Baylor would have any problem with that at this point.
Nice tackle in the backfield. That was John Miller knifing in. That's going to be it. Well, the crowd loves it here at Floyd Casey Stadium in Waco because that Baylor defense, that good old Baylor line, has been holding the Texas Aggies. Baylor got the punt. The Aggies got the ball first against the wind, couldn't drive. Kicked it to Baylor, and Baylor went down and scored a field goal off the foot of Jeff Ireland. Then on the next play, next series, James Francis blocked a punt for a safety. It was 5-0. Then Ireland added another field goal to make it 8-0 Baylor. And Ray, the Aggies just haven't been able to get anything generated offensively.
I would think, though, Bill, they'll make some adjustments and do some heavy talking in halftime. They dug themselves somewhat of a hole, but there's still 30 minutes of football left, and anything can happen. And with the talent they have, those kids start playing a little bit more together and a little bit harder in the second half. I think it's going to be a heck of a ball game.
We'll be back with more halftime activities from Waco, Texas, right after we take this break on HSE.
If we're going to win this war on drugs, we got to get the drug dealers first. Somebody get caught selling drugs, we're going to take their assets, put them in prison, and keep them there. The drugs they sell kill a child, we're going to give them the death penalty. We're going to lick this drug problem. We're going to have to learn to be tough and stay tough.
Somebody tells you we can't win this war on drugs, you tell them ahead and met Clayton Williams.
Completely renovated with the very best heating and cooling system.
Must be a Lennox.
So we put in this new central air and our bills are really
down.
Exactly.
Must be a Lennox.
Our furnace, not a day of trouble ever.
Must be a good one.
Must be a Lennox.
It must be.
Lennox Heating and Air Conditioning since 1895. Must be a Lennox.
Attaboy, Dave.
My name is J.B. Hutchins. I'm a golf professional at Memorial Park Golf Course. My job is to make your golf game as enjoyable as possible. See a Southern Texas golf pro.
Welcome back at halftime to Floyd Casey Stadium, where right now the Baylor Bears are pitching a shutout, 8-0, over the Texas Aggies. So far, it's been a real defensive struggle. A couple of field goals by Baylor, and also a safety on a block punt by James Francis. So the Baylor Bears getting the job done in the first half of play. And it's always a pleasure when we come to Waco to visit with Bill Menefee, the athletic director of the Baylor football and basketball, all of the programs here in Waco at Baylor. And Bill, you have to be pleased right now with the way the game is going, because the winner here stays on track for a berth in the Cotton Bowl.
We're delighted with the outcome so far. This is always a hard-fought game and always a very good game. And so I'm very happy that HSE is televising this game and that all the people see it. But we're very happy with our lot right now.
Bill, I'm really impressed with the stadium, especially your all-pro turf that you laid down this year. Beautiful green carpet to play football on here at Floyd Casey. And it's just the first of many renovations, isn't it, by Baylor?
This is true. Our coaches like our turf. It's very soft, has a nice crown on it. As you can see, it's very colorful with the gold end zone with the green Baylor trimmed in white in it. It's very, very colorful and a very, very good feel. It is phase one of our renovation and our north end zone project.
And what else do you have in the plans in the works for this stadium?
Well, this is an $8 million project. We got a great start with Mr. Carl Casey donating $5 million, and we're still working toward the $8 million. And, of course, as you know, it was named Floyd Casey Stadium. All of our football facilities will move to the north end zone. We'll have our strength room, our training room, our dressing rooms, our meeting rooms, all the things pertaining to football will be on the first floor. The second floor will contain the ticket office and all of the athletic coaches' offices. And the third floor will be a Bear Club and VIP area where we can entertain our donors.
Facilities are super, and I know, being an old basketball coach, you're awfully proud of the gold dome that you see when you drive into Waco, and that's Farrell Coliseum.
It's a very beautiful field house, and we are so very proud of it. Baylor has come from a dead last in the Southwest Conference in facilities, and we're moving on up toward the top now. And when we get Floyd Casey Stadium complete, the north end zone and the renovation of the press box and new elevators and all the other things that we're doing over here, well, we will be first class, and we're just delighted with the progress we have made.
Bill, thanks a million. You're always a super host here at Baylor University.
Thank you very much, Bill.
Bill Menefee, our halftime guest. We're going to take a break right now, and we'll be back in just a moment with the Baylor Bear Band.
Memorable moments in NFL history can now be yours in an all-new video cassette collection. Presenting the official NFL Films video collection from NFL Films, Fox Hills, and Time Life. Now you can replay the greatest games, the mammoth feats of the legendary linemen, the suspense of the Super Bowls, and more. Kick off your collection with the toughest, most explosive players in the game. They're all part of your first video cassette, Crunch Course. Just $14.99 plus shipping and handling. The official NFL Films video collection. Here's how to order.
Call now 1-800-262-0900 to get your first video cassette, Crunch Course, at the low introductory price of just $14.99. Or send 1822 to NFL Video Collection, P.O. Box 1880, Department 26, Alexandria, Virginia.
Back at halftime, where Baylor leads Texas A&M 8-0. Let's go down to the field now and enjoy the Baylor Bear Marching Band.
Such as awesome. Favorite feature for the Gina, the Senior National Tournament Tom, summertime.
It's fueled the victories of Super Bowl champions and Sandlot superstars. It's as welcome on a hot cinder track as a cold sheet of ice. It is unsurpassed at supplying fluids, minerals, and energy. It goes beyond refreshment. It produces results. It's everywhere athletes compete. It's sports. It's Gatorade.
I was going to take a job with an engineering firm in New York. I got a better offer. I'm building schools overseas with the Peace Corps. The pace is a little slower than New York, but here I'm getting grassroots experience I couldn't get anywhere else. The way I look at it, the world can wait 2 years for another 40-story smoked glass high-rise.
Peace Corps, the toughest job you'll ever love.
Hi, I'm Ron Colville, golf professional at Walden on Lake Conroe, inviting you to see your Southern Texas golf professional to help improve your game.
Well, we're just about ready to go with the second half of play. The Baylor Bears pitching a shutout in the first half over Texas A&M, 8-0, and it was caused by some great defense by Baylor. Already leading 3-0. Watch Sean Wilson trying to get off this punt. James Francis through to block the punt. It rolled out of the end zone for a safety, and Baylor led 5-0. Then the Baylor Bears were marching down trying to make it more, and watch the blitz from the left side by Gary Jones. It creates a fumble by Gable, and it looks like William Thomas came away with the fumble, and A&M held off Baylor. But then the Aggies are coming right back, trying to get back into the game. Lance Pavlis fumbled the snap from center, and there's that man again, James Francis, recovering the fumble. But the Aggies kept blitzing Gable all day long, and here's another one by A&M, Mickey Washington, and Washington takes him down. So as you see, it's been a defensive struggle all the way. First downs, only 5 for the Aggies. Only in total yards, A&M with 105 total yards. And the time of possession is almost double for Baylor, Ray.
Yeah, except, Bill, sometimes time of possession can be misleading because of big plays. A block punt, for example, got 2 points on there, but been a defensive struggle all the way, as you said.
Well, one of the real surprises going on around the country today, and we'll show you some of the scores that we have here at halftime on your Budweiser scoreboard, and Alabama just pounding Tennessee. Of course, Tennessee losing their All-American running back, the youngster Cobb, earlier this week. Alabama really pouring it on. Michigan State is about 13 points away from maybe being the number one team in the nation.
Right.
They played a tough schedule tied with Illinois. And look at this shocker. Texas by 10 over Arkansas in the fourth quarter. And Texas would have the inside track. TCU really jumping all over D. Dallas and the Air Force Academy. And here we go. Trooper Taylor at the 22-yard line.
Bill, it was Texas A&M's option, and they elected to take the wind in the third quarter. A lot of guys, you know, that's a matter of philosophy. A lot of guys like to have the wind in the fourth quarter. So apparently Coach Slocum and them decided they wanted to win to get back in the football game in the third quarter.
I think that's a good choice because they need some momentum. The Aggies just haven't been able to generate anything. Now they'll ask for their defense to set the tone, hold Baylor. And that's the key here. Don't let Baylor run that ball out of here because the wind is still right into Baylor's face and it's gusting up to about 25 miles per hour. You can see the jersey sleeves blowing on Brad Gable.
I would think maybe it may have picked up a little bit more than that now, Bill, the way it looks out on the field.
And Gable's going to pass. He got a sailor off, but what a catch by David Frost as he went high. The junior out of Edmond, Oklahoma. Gary Jones wrapped him up, but this ball just took off into that wind.
Yeah, nice catch by the receiver. He extended his arms up and caught the football. As you said, it just skied on him. And did a good job of hanging on and making positive yardage after he caught it.
Well, it was a gain of 12 for a Baylor first down. I tell you, they're throwing all caution into the wind.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, this is a very, very, very big series for both football teams.
Hand off, Raphael, right side. Good job of penetration by Terry Price, the senior out of Plano. 6'5", 272-pounder. Jeroy Robinson also down there. And so is Anthony Williams.
Raphael had a little bit of a seam inside and elected to come outside a little bit east-west, and I would imagine he'd like to turn it on up inside there, and I think he'd have made more positive yards.
No gain on the play. Brings up second and 10. Raphael across the middle. Oh, there was a collision at the 41-yard line. Alonzo Pierce, the intended receiver, and Mickey Washington went right through him.
That's a great break on the football, Bill. What's the break?
Number 26, Kevin Smith.
Actually, that was Smith. That was Kevin Smith and not Washington.
That is a big-time break on the football right there. That's the guy that Rex made to play.
Third down and 10 now for Baylor.
You got three receivers to the top. You might anticipate screen or draw right here to be a conservative call on third and 10.
Blitz. He got it away. In time to Murray. Going to be a big gainer. Murray gets 11. Before he's brought down by Larry Horton. But a first down Baylor Bears. And what a great job Gable did. He read the blitz by William Thomas.
He saw it, and they had the screen called. It was a good job to execute, and he held the ball as long as he possibly could to deliver it to Murray. And then great execution by the lineman out in front and a good job of carrying the football. There's a Turnbow out there in front again.
Yeah.
Big Mubba is out running around. I'm impressed the way that guy moves.
He comes to the stadium. They must park him with the mobile homes. First down and 10. Raphael to the right side. Got a pretty good block almost to midfield. I'll tell you, that Murray does a good job of blocking and catching the football, number 24.
That's why he's on scholarship, William. He better.
That's why he's not only on scholarship, he's the first teamer. Murray came into the game with 27 catches. He's caught two today. And he really has done a job this season for Grant Tabb. He's only run with the ball 10 times this season. That's a tie-dye formation.
And we're going to shift out to the...
There goes Murray with one of his rare carries, and it did not fool William Thomas. Got into the backfield.
Texas A&M continually kind of jumps around at the line of scrimmage. I don't know whether they're trying to get an edge or there's some... They think they have the snap count, but they almost were offsides in.
But, you know, even if Baylor now has to kick, this has been an excellent drive because the Bears have moved it to midfield, and A&M wanted to hold them down there as far as they could.
Plus, they've eaten 2.5 minutes off the clock.
Third down and 8 for Gable. Baylor 50% on third down conversions. Make it better than that. Completion to Greg Anderson for a Baylor first down.
Bill, they put two receivers into the wide side of the field, and Gable sprinted. There was no pressure. They didn't have any contain, and he had a lot of time to set his feet and threw the football.
Derek Ritchie just gave him too much cushion, didn't he?
Yeah. And I tell you, when you've got that much time, particularly throwing to your left, to set your feet and get your shoulders square, you need to bring a little bit of heat on him from the outside.
Gable first and 10. Going to hand it off again. Raphael going right. Correction, that's Lincoln Coleman, number 29. Sophomore out of Dallas. William Thomas wrapped him up.
Bill, that's a great play by William Thomas. He takes a tight end on and feathers it and slow plays it all the way down the sideline. Watch him. Watch number 11 here at the bottom of the screen. He's got his pads, hands on his pads, controls him, comes off, and makes a play. That's a great play.
Well, you're right. The technique was just excellent on the play by Thomas. A loss of 3 brings up second and 13 Baylor. Just inside A&M territory. Murray and Coleman in the backfield for Baylor. Gable wants a quick out pattern. He's got it. Did he have control of the ball? Anderson, yes, they're calling it complete, but I don't know. Now, I just don't think he had this ball when he went out of bounds.
Looks like there was a little juggling going on. He may have, in the official's mind, he may have had his feet down and had the control of the ball.
Nope.
Nope.
That's incomplete. Never had it. He was bobbling it all the way out.
Maybe we can get on his replay judges.
Well, they suspended one last week, you know.
Oh, I didn't know that. Blitz again.
Blitz. Third down and six. Blitz coming, huh? It was offsides, too, by A&M. Little out pattern. Incomplete. Intended for Reggie Miller. And there is a flag right at the 40, and it looked like Thomas may have jumped off sides. If he did, it's going to bring up a third and one rather than a third and six.
Yeah, they just X'd the two outside receivers anticipating man coverage. But again, Texas A&M, with the guy being offsides, turned it into a third and one.
Defense, offside, 5-yard penalty, repeat, third down.
Well, the Bears are getting all the breaks, aren't they?
That'll drive you to lose all your hair, that right there.
And yours is still red.
Yeah, a little bit red. Two tights with a wing over here. Strong set on this side.
Coleman, I think he got it.
Yeah, that's good ball carry. He got his shoulder square, and he hit the line of scrimmage, and his pads down, and made the yard. That's an excellent job.
Gilstrap did a good job at pounding in there, and you look at Scott McCool. Got the first big block. And it's first down, Baylor.
Bill, they've kept the ball 4 minutes and 51 seconds as of this point right now in the wind. And they're now, I would say, with the wind, even the factor that it is, that Ireland's capable of kicking a field goal from in this rain.
Ball on the A&M 34-yard line. That's Gilstrap, moves over, split backfield. Off Gilstrap, and they had a mix-up in the backfield, and Gable was lucky that they didn't bobble that handoff.
Yeah. The thing I'm sure Grant Tavenham were interested in is not making a mistake right now with the football, and Texas A&M's trying to make something happen.
Looks like Terry Gray, the big left tackle for Baylor's, got to come off the field. Gary Camp's going to come in for him. Gray's 285 out of Klein Oak High School, and he's really limping. They're taking him over to the Baylor bench.
Terry played at Cisco Junior College, I believe. A really, really pleasant young man. I saw him when we were out there recruiting a couple of years ago.
So Camp will have to block on Aaron Wallace, who has just come into the game for A&M. Quick out pattern intended for Alonzo Pierce. Overthrown. That's going to bring up third down.
This is a very big play for both sides of the football right here. It's on the 35-yard line. You got to figure Baylor thinks it's four down territory. They may punch the ball, but I would guess they probably won't. Texas A&M's got to hold them at this point.
Reggie Miller and Greg Anderson. Blanked out to the upper part of your screen. Gilstrap remains in the game with Coleman. Third down. Baylor. Gable as a receiver. What a catch by Reggie Miller at the A&M 15-yard line. Oh, my. Kevin Smith was right there for the Aggies. But this young freshman out of Waco, talk about earning your scholarship.
That's a nice throwing catch. Excellent concentration. He's the inside receiver. He's going to run a post corner, and the outside receiver just ran a flat and he cleared it out with no underneath coverage.
20-yard gain on the play.
Excellent protection. A good job of Gable getting his shoulder square, and a really nice catch by Miller.
Gable is now 10 of 18 for 104 yards. A ball on the 15-yard line. What a drive this has been. Coleman going left. He gets a couple. Anthony Williams was right there to stop him. But keep in mind now, this Baylor drive started back on the Bear 20-yard line to open up this third quarter. And as you pointed out, Ray, not only is it taking ticks off the clock, but now they've got a chance to get some points on the board.
Well, I'd say now, Bill, they're going to be not conservative, but they're going to do things to control the football because they've got a chance to get at least 3 points on the board. I would feel like they feel pretty secure about that.
Little flare pass. Lincoln Coleman at the 10, at the 5. And he's finally stopped by William Thomas, but Lincoln Coleman did a fine job of getting down, I think, with enough yardage for a Baylor first down at the 5-yard line.
They bring William Thomas from the outside, and I think he's supposed to peel dog or take this guy man when he flares. As you can see him run upfield and then turn and run with him. Just a slip screen to the back.
Well, Horton couldn't wrap him up. He could have stopped him shy of the first of the yardage necessary for the first down, but Horton didn't wrap him up, and it's a Baylor first down. Goal to go at the A&M 5-yard line.
Bill, over 6 minutes, almost 7 minutes now used up into the wind, and I think that's a really, really critical stat.
And 75 yards so far on the drive by Baylor. That's Murray in motion. Oh, he had the tight end intercepted by Kevin Smith. A big turnover for the Aggies. It looked like it may have hit a Baylor receiver or somebody tipped it. Kevin Smith got the interception for A&M. Watch Steve Stutzman, number 80. No, that's Alonzo Pierce. And a good job by Kevin Smith and the Aggies. Get the turnover. We'll take a break. A long drive by Baylor does not get any points for the Bears. And now the Aggies will try to get it back.
In 1876, Texas A&M University is founded as a land-grant college. 1971, designated a sea-grant college. At the close of the 80s, it achieves space-grant status. Land-grant, sea-grant, space-grant. One of a select few in the nation. Texas A&M University, meeting challenges through teaching, research, and public service, now and into the 21st century.
The news is out, announcing the debut of the hottest trivia game ever, All-Star Entertainment Trivia. Call 1-900-CAN-I-WIN. Answer 6 questions correctly and you'll win $100 on the spot. That's right, $100. If you love showbiz, you'll love this trivia game. Call 1-900-CAN-I-WIN from a touch-tone phone. You'll get questions on movies, television, and your favorite stars. Plus, you can win $100 on the spot. Call now, 1-900-CAN-I-WIN for All-Star Entertainment Trivia. Just 95 cents per minute added to your phone bill.
Bill, at 6.5 minutes into the win, although they didn't get any points, he did eat up a lot of valuable time off that clock. But that has certainly changed or shifted the momentum of the football game.
Lewis was tackled by James Francis. It's going to be a penalty against Baylor, however. There's a flag on the play. Let's listen to Wendell Shelton once he sorts it out. Going to be a big one against Baylor. 15-yarder. So, boy, that
by the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
That's a 25-yard play for A&M. So just like that, Grant Taft sees his team first and goal from the 5, no points, and the Aggies come right back out to the 45. Boy, this could be a huge turnover.
Yeah, that's really what causes you to pull your hair out. It's just a simple deal. The swing has gone and the momentum. You used to notice the Aggie players in their huddle on offense. They're all jumping around. They seem to be more pumped up.
8:18 left to play in the third. Pavlis. Play action. Looking across the middle.
Got holding on James Francis, Bill.
Well, Percy Waddle was double covered. Robert Blackman had him like a blanket.
Darren Lewis could not block him. He just had to grab him and hold him.
So you're saying James Francis on the blitz?
Yeah.
He and Lewis just, with a hold.
Yeah, he just could not grab him. He grabbed him, but he couldn't hold him even then. There would be a lot of guys that would probably have to grab and hold him.
Well, especially with Francis at 6'4", 248. You know, that's the third time A&M has tried that deep pass to Waddle across the middle.
And they've had it. They've had two people on top, but one on top and one underneath both times, or all three times.
Defense, 10-yard penalty, still first down.
Well, they're going to back them up now. So it'll be first down and 20. Ball back on the A&M 35-yard line. Paddle is so far only 5 of 14 for 52 yards. This is not one of his better days passing. Lewis got almost collared by Santana Dotson in the backfield.
Yeah, that could have cost him his head right there if he hadn't ducked under a little bit.
Dotson's been a big player for Baylor a couple of years now. Sophomore out of Yates. Makes some big plays.
He has some good genes, too. I understand his father played for the Oakland Raiders, I believe, Alfonso Dotson. What the Aggies have to do right here, Bill, is get at least half of this on second down so they have a chance to get the other half on third down.
Lewis went in motion. Now Lewis with the ball at the 32, trying to get a block. Got up to just shy of the 40-yard line. Mike Welch was the first one there. Well, talk about a hitter now, Mike Welch.
Brady one, Reggie Howard.
He does a great job on Kenny out here. He makes him miss him in the flatter. It would have been for about a 7-8-yard loss.
Reggie Howard with good pursuit here, too.
Ooh, that's a nice shot.
Third down, the Aggies need to get to the Baylor 45-yard line. So it's third and 15 for Pavlos. Big rush, and he's wrapped up. Darren Franklin, along with James Francis, coming on the blitz. They love it in Waco.
Baylor had a little trouble getting lined up, Bill. As you can see, Francis is running up the top of the screen. But Pavlos never sees him coming.
Yeah, he was busy trying to dodge Franklin. He couldn't worry about Francis.
Right.
Gonna be a bad snap. Can he get it off? No, he can't. And Baylor with another kicking game mistake by the Aggies.
That's the quickest way in college football to turn one around. I'm thoroughly convinced a mistake in the kicking game. They've had a blocked punt already. Now the mishandled snap. Great field position again for Baylor. He just can't make those mistakes.
Sean Wilson was back that time, and Francis playing a lot of heat on the play. So Baylor has really done a job on the kicking team and the kicking game today to create some huge turnovers.
Baylor really, really needs to come away with some points here.
Now remember, A&M took the wind, and the Aggies haven't been able to do a thing with the wind to their backs. It's been all Baylor against the wind. 6 minutes left to play in the third quarter. And it's to Lincoln Coleman, who's been a workhorse, might be holding on Baylor.
Lincoln Coleman, Anthony Williams and Terry Potts,
another good play by William Thomas, Bill.
No, they're going to be a face mask again. That's the fourth face mask penalty.
I've never seen so many face mask penalties in one football game.
Did they have face masks when you played?
The face mask by the defense. That's a 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Actually,
those were those old leather helmets.
Right. Where you just folded them up and took them home with you. There was a grab, but I think it would be a 5-yard penalty. I covered a lot of kickoffs without any kind of helmet on. I think that's probably where.
All right, second down and one. Baylor. There are the penalties. So far in the game, the Aggies have just not been sharp. And again, somebody moved. Somebody on that Baylor line, Monty Jones, may have picked up his hand.
Ball start. Offense still playing first down.
So on this possession, they've had trouble getting it started. Grant Taft running in a play.
You know, it's amazing. Grant Taft's been here 18 years. Most guys don't survive in this business 18 years anywhere.
What a great coach and great person. One of the best motivational speakers anywhere in the world.
And has done it here at a private institution, which many people think
catch by the comeback kid, Bobby Jack Goforth. And listen to the hand they give him here in Waco. He had a touchdown pass last week against SMU. They said he would not play at all this year. He had serious surgery to repair his knee. And they said he'd miss his senior season. He went into Coach Taft's office. He said, Coach, I'm going to be a chapter in your next book. I'm coming back.
Well, I think he's made it. There was an interesting story about him in the Houston Chronicle yesterday that I enjoyed reading. And you always pull for a coach's kid.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care where he's playing. You always feel those guys have a tough enough struggle. So I was really pleased. But he has really worked hard to get to this point and return to being able to play and being productive.
Well, he was going to be a big, big part of this Baylor team coming back, and that's how close it is for a first down for Baylor. But Bobby Jack is back. In last year's game at College Station, Goforth had two touchdown receptions for Baylor as they jumped out to a 14-0 lead, the Bears did. But A&M came back for 21 points in the fourth quarter to win it 28-14.
I think, if I'm not mistaken, I believe he caught five passes for 110 yards in that ball game.
Yes, he did.
Very productive afternoon.
They say he still has a little nerve damage in the knee that was repaired by surgery, so he drags that leg a little bit, but if you can get the ball anywhere around Goforth, he's going to catch it. He's got a great set of hands.
Hell, I tell you, anybody that's been around the game and knows about reconstructions knows how hard you have to work to get it rebuilt.
Baylor needs one on second down. Will they run it or will they go for the whole enchilada? They're going to run Lincoln Coleman, and he's made it all day long. He's got it this time. Anthony Williams was there to meet him. But it's going to be a Baylor first down.
I tell you, the right side of the Baylor line is really beginning to come off the football well. There's good explosion and good movement. Been on the play before on the pass completion. They had single coverage out here, and Kevin Smith was off of him a good distance. They hit him with just a little turnaround out there.
Goforth and Miller at the top of your screen on first down. Gable looking left side. He's got Miller and overthrows him. Goforth took the cornerback out of the end zone, but he didn't fool Gary Jones.
Intended for number 19, Reggie Miller. Number one,
Miller becoming more and more a part of the Baylor offense as each week goes by.
I would say he's become a big part today. Boy, he has played very well. They're trying to go to him again, and you can see he's got some running room.
Boy, he was open.
I'm wondering if maybe Goforth, they had run this route earlier, and the outside receiver went in the flat, and Goforth just went on a go route up the field. It may have supposed to have been broken into the flat.
Lee Miles comes into the game. Look at the time of possession by Baylor and this quarter with 4:48 left to play. Play action blitz, Aaron Wallace, and he ducked it. Gable ducked it. He's got a man open, and it's a completed pass to Stutzman at the 7-yard line. Oh, my goodness. The Baptists are living right today.
I'll tell you. It's fortunate for Gable he ducked when he did.
Well, Aaron Wallace, look at him come from the top of your screen. He is tied for sacks with Jacob Green in his career at A&M. That would have given him the all-time leadership, and he didn't come up with it.
I tell you, Bill, that's just a great heads-up play of feeling pressure coming by Gable. He had to feel that coming.
He couldn't have seen it. That's right. Gable must have tremendous peripheral vision, Ray, because he does pick up a lot from that backside.
Either that or he heard him snorting when he was coming back.
He heard him coming. Well,
or the ground pounding, maybe. That's what it was.
Yeah. Well, they need about a half yard. Can you believe Baylor has had the ball almost the entire quarter? 4:40 left to play in the third, and the Bears have been going against the wind, so that nullifies A&M's advantage of taking that breeze.
Right. Well, you got to give Baylor's both sides of the ball a great deal of credit. They've stopped them when they had to, and they've continued to make plays on offense.
Gable has made good on 13 of 21 for 126 yards. This is a big third and one. Lincoln Coleman over the top. First down, Baylor at the five. Well, Raphael got banged up early in the game, and Coleman, they haven't missed a beat with this youngster.
Rafael is standing over close to Coach Taft and his offensive coaches, but Coleman is really doing a good job of running the football.
Yep. Don't try to fix it. It don't need fixing right now. Stay right there with Coleman.
Baylor has always run some option, blast option down on the goal line.
Coleman again. Oh, Gable almost signaled touchdown and thought he was going to bust through, and then Gary Jones did a good job of coming up and stopping him at the 2-yard line. It looked for just a moment he was going to bust through.
This just an old, just the old blast out of the eye, power eye formation. Lead both blacks backs through and hit it to the tailback and let him hit it running.
Boy, Gary Jones made a heck of a play, but here it is. It's down to just about the 1. Second and goal, Baylor. Coleman.
Great
good
penetration.
Job by William Thomas as he got in from under the turf almost.
That was a great job of penetrating. Terry Price was under there. They lost yardage on that. And I would look now, again, Baylor has always run the option down here on the goal line out of the blast. I wouldn't be a bit surprised to see him come with run the ball outside a little bit.
Thomas has really become the big play man for the Aggies this year. 3 sacks last week. All right. Goal to go, Baylor. Off tackle. Good play again by Gary Jones. Lincoln Coleman going right side, but Gary Jones, the strong safety, got penetration into the backfield, and it's going to bring up fourth down and still goal to go. What do you do if you're Grant Tech?
Bill, that's why they pay those big salaries, baby. I would imagine it looks kind of like they're going to go for it, but I tell you, that's great play by the Aggie defense here.
Tell you what, Ray, I think I'd kick a field goal.
Well, 3 points makes it 11. If they score and kick the extra point, makes it 15. A&M's got to score twice and go for 2 to beat them or 3 times to win.
Well, here's the ball game. Could be. Fourth down, goal to go, Baylor. Coleman. No! The Aggies hold him. Gary Jones and William Thomas lead the charge. Coleman had to stop. He had nowhere to go.
There was no place to go. The Texas A&M got great penetration. I'm sure Price is under there. Thomas is under there. There's Jones over the top. They're just Kevin Smith. They're just winning place for him.
So the Aggies have intercepted a ball in the end zone to stave off one Baylor rally. And now hold on first and goal from the 1 here. And what can Pavlis do to try to get the A&M offense on track? 2:16 to play. He's going to turn and hand it to his big running back, Robert Wilson.
I would guess, Bill, if they can get him a little working room, they're going to at least try to go uptown, downtown one time with the wind at their back.
Well, the important thing here for A&M now is if you have to punt, you want to punt with that wind to your back. If you make a first down and run that clock out at 150, you might have to punt from the other one.
Right.
A&M needs 8. Hand off again to Wilson.
They won't. If they just keep running the ball on the ground, though, they should be able to punt with the wind.
Now, again, too, now that Sean Wilson has had problems with the punting game today. He's had 1 block. So,
and then the 1 mistake on the
one mistake,
mishandle the ball or bad snap or whatever it was.
So Baylor would relish an A&M punt from down in this territory. So the Aggies really need a first down here, 3rd down and 6 for A&M. That's Wilson in motion. Pavlis going to tuck it and run at the 10, and the Baylor Bears converge at the 10-yard line. James Francis, along with Robert Blackman and Harry Joe Kinney.
Boy, Bill, there's been some great contact in this football game.
Boy, here's some here. Watch Malcolm Frank. Okay, now Sean Elliott. Sean Wilson, I'm thinking of the basketball player already. for San Antonio. Wilson in his end zone. Keep an eye on Francis. He's already blocked one. He dropped it. But they weren't coming with the rush. And it's a good kick by Wilson. Greg Anderson at the 30.
Got a seam.
He's got a seam, you're right, at the 45. And a good job of staying home by Kevin Smith. So A&M punts out of harm's way. Baylor 8. A&M nothing with 9 seconds left to play in the third quarter.
Raised in rural Fort Stockton, Clayton Williams learned early the importance of hard work and strong family values. After college in the U.S. Army, he would waste no time in his pursuit of the American dream. Oil and natural gas, farming, ranching, high-tech telecommunications, Clayton Williams would become a Texas legend. Founder of 26 companies, he has created 100,000 jobs in 50 cities and towns. Clayton Williams, he'll make Texas great again.
We have a problem back here.
Let's get some light on. He's going to be attacked now.
Start an IV, pull a supply to Kane's.
You're 200 miles north of the nearest hospital and 31,000 feet above it. In the Air Force, you really have to know what you're doing because there's no one there to do it for you.
Gonna be fine.
Aim high. Air Force.
Hi, I'm Carl Baker of Atascocita Country Club. If you want to give your game the competitive edge, go see your Southern Texas golf professional. He's working for you.
Bill, Kevin Smith did an excellent job on that punt returner, keeping outside leverage, and because there was a seam inside of him, your tendency is to collapse on that. And he stayed outside and he broke it back out to him.
Well, that really saved the day. That would have been shocking for the Aggies after that brilliant goal line stand. The A&M defense has done everything it can do. The offense has sputtered all day long. Now here comes Baylor again. And after this play, the Bears will have the win. Jeff Murray, Lincoln Coleman in the I formation. Coleman, right guard, gain of 4. Anthony Williams on the tackle.
Bill, Texas Baylor is in two tight ends with one wide receiver again, which they use to just line up and hammer the football at him.
Well, that's the end of the third quarter of play. The Baylor Bears own the football almost the entire period against the wind. And now Baylor will have that wind at blowing in 25 miles per hour when we return for the final 15.
System.
Must be a Lennox.
So we put in this new central air, and our bills are really
down?
Exactly.
Must be a Lennox.
Our furnace? Not a day of trouble ever.
Must be a good one.
Must be a Lennox.
It must be.
Lennox Heating and Air Conditioning. Since 1895. Must be a Lennox.
Attaboy, Dave.
This is a year of celebration, the 75th year of Southwest Conference football, and the 30th anniversary of our Texas Football Magazine. To acknowledge our 30th year, we've produced a commemorative issue entitled The Best of Texas Football. This special edition captures many of the classic stories that have appeared on the magazine's pages through the years. The great names, the great games, the highs and lows, all are included in The Best of Texas Football. Get your copy now at newsstands everywhere.
Tickets for the 1990 Mobile Cotton Bowl Classic are on sale now. Call toll-free 1-800-638-BOWL.
The Marine Reserve. Are you up to the challenge?
This is Zulu 4-5. Fire 4 effect. Over.
If you're a former Marine, then join the proud team. Take the challenge. Reserve your place on the team now. The Marine Reserve.
Defeating A&M with 15 more minutes to go, 8-0, and Texas has just defeated Arkansas 24-20 in Fayetteville. So this is the 20th reunion of the big shootout, and 1969, and Texas has done it again, Ray Auburn.
I think there are very few people who would have thought that was going to happen, Bill. When you were talking, you and I were talking to all these people in the press box, everybody was talking about the winner of this game going head-to-head with Arkansas.
Yeah, and now it's head-to-head with Texas.
Texas escapes a bullet against Rice by 1 point. I'm sure looking a week ahead to Oklahoma. They beat Oklahoma in a great win, and they may be on their way now.
Ray, the key, I think, for Texas was settling on a quarterback. They found young Peter Gardere, the youngster out of Houston Lee, and he has solidified that Texas offense.
I tell you, Bill, he's, of course, doesn't take a rocket scientist, but he's a great athlete, and he'll get better and better as he plays.
Well, back to action at this one, 15 minutes left. Lincoln Coleman, he just makes a wise decision. He sees Anthony Williams coming like a freight train, and he says, I don't want any part of that.
Anthony Williams dropping down.
Well, the winner of this game now still has to play Arkansas and Texas. Arkansas with one loss. Texas still undefeated.
That changes the complete complexion of the race.
And congratulations to Mr. Wacker and the Horned Frogs for defeating the Air Force today, 27-9. Ball tipped, intercepted, A&M. There's that man, Kevin Smith, at the 33-yard line. The ball was deflected at the line of scrimmage, and I didn't get a number, but somebody got a hand on the football, and Kevin Smith has been making big plays for A&M all day long.
Yeah, he is. He's just been an outstanding player all year, but particularly today, a bunch of big football plays.
Who hits it, Ray? Oh, there he is, William Thomas.
I want to tell you, they need to give that guy a couple of game balls after this is over. He and Kevin Smith. But look, he's over there blocking.
Oh, and boy, did you see the shot that Kevin Smith took in the back after that interception?
You know, he's such a good athlete, as I mentioned earlier. We thought Kevin would be a great wide receiver and run and shoot. That kind of talent.
Sophomore out of Orange, Texas. He and William Thomas combining to make another big play. That's three big plays for William Thomas today. All right, it's first down and 10. The Aggies trailing by 8. Handoff. Darren Lewis looking for running room. Look at the green jerseys.
That's just great defensive football there.
Curtis Hafford, Malcolm Frank, Darren Franklin. They were all over the football.
Bill, it's almost mandatory that Texas A&M get some points out of this series right here.
The wind is still gusting into the faces of the Aggies, about 20-25 miles per hour. Still plenty of time, 13:41 left to play. Pavlis on the option to Lewis. Oh, what a play by the man, James Francis.
He may not have been the leading tackler going in, but he's gained some ground on him today, I'll tell you. Well, Kenny's out there with him. They're both right there.
Isn't it amazing, though, Ray, in this game of big plays, the big play men are making them. Thomas for the Aggies, Kevin Smith, and James Francis for the Bears.
I tell you, Bill, I think it was McCall that tried to get down on Francis there, and he ripped him and ran by and made the play.
Third down, Pavlis needs 12 to keep this Aggie drive alive. Pavlis. Got a lot of time in the pocket. Nice pass, and it's dropped. Intended for Gary Oliver. Boy, he had it wrapped up. What a throw by Pavlis.
Yeah, he really, really throws this ball well. He steps up, squares himself, and delivers it, and hits him right in the hands.
Oh, my goodness. He did a good job of eluding Robert Blackman. Boy, it just makes you want to find a seam in that all-pro turf and get under it.
Well, really, you know, kids don't do that on purpose. There's a lot of pressure.
Now the Aggies are going to go for it. They're not going to punt. Fourth and 12. R.C. Slocum says, I've got to go for it.
Well, you're on the 34-yard line. The most you're going to get is probably the ball to the 20.
Fourth down. Aggies need 12 to keep it going. That's Patterson in motion. Long pass to Patterson. Can he catch up to it? Oh, there's going to be interference called on Daniel Morgan for Baylor. Cornelius Patterson Morgan got a piece of him at about the 3-yard line. Now remember, see, it's only a 10-yard penalty, huh?
15, I believe. But Coach Staff is signaling the ball was over his head, uncatchable. But, you know, you get into that discussion now when the guy grabs him by the foot, can he catch it or not? That's always a problem that you have. I think it's a good call.
Pavlis threw it into that wind, Ray, and it just died.
Defensive pass interference, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Oh, a big play.
Is that a big play or not, Ray?
Oh, yeah. Morgan just ran right up his back. Let's watch it again.
I tell you, Pavlis was lucky. Francis was about to come loose.
Yeah, see, you see the contact. You didn't get a good look at it, but you will hear. There's the contact. Yeah, you can't tell. He might have...
The ball's awfully far, is awfully good distance inside, but that's still hard to gauge it.
Ball at the 19-yard line, Baylor. Oh, what a hit.
Got a holding call.
John Godfrey really put a hit on Darren Lewis. There's a flag, however, on the play.
Got two of them. One may be defensive holding, one may be offensive holding.
Baylor signaling against the Aggies. And a clip.
Clip.
And a hole. Well, they...
That's dealer's choice.
They got you now, don't they?
Yeah.
So R.C. Slocum says they got us. Really, of course, we can't see any of the rest of the play to see where it might have occurred, but with two flags...
I think the hold was right there on 52.
Mm-hmm. That's what they say about offensive linemen. You never mention their name until they make a mistake.
By the offense is refused. Clipping by the offense is accepted. 15-yard penalty and a first down.
Yeah, the clipping will give you 5 more yards. So Baylor takes that extra 5 yards, refuses the holding. Now look at A&M. The Aggies with 8 penalties on the day. Baylor with 7. So now the team mistake-free today. It'll be first down and 25. The ball needs to get down to the Baylor 10-yard line for an A&M first down.
Watch Wilson in this situation. They've gone to him before throwing the ball.
Pavlis going to go to Lewis instead. What a great open field tackle. Curtis Happer, number 99, a sophomore out of Jasper, Texas.
Seen that young man play, too, right up the road. Very, very talented player.
Ray, when you bring down Darren Lewis in the open field, that's something.
Yeah. He's a little bit extended. That's just a great play by Curtis Happer there.
Only weighs 197 pounds. Good mobility. Second down, still 25 for A&M. Play action. Going to throw back to Lewis, overthrew him, and guess who was right in the middle of everything? James Francis. When Pavlis looked to his left, he saw Lewis, but he also saw Francis.
Yeah. That guy's had him a great afternoon. A little play action here. Which on... Second and 25, you know, you do it more for protection and try to get a screen, get a mismatch out here outside. Now we got 3 receivers to the bottom of the field.
Reggie Howard had a lot of pressure on that last play, and it's still 3rd and 25, blitz. Pavlis running for his life. Santana Dotson all over him. Pavlis gets it away. He's got a receiver. Intercepted by Baylor in the end zone. Frankie Smith. Tell you what, they almost had it simultaneously because that was a great job by Gary Oliver to try to get it, but Smith took it right away from him.
Well, I tell you what, had he had a chance to slow up just a little bit, as you can see the pressure he's under here, he may have been able to hit Oliver down there.
Pavlis did a heck of a job. First of all, Yerick Long put the pressure from the right side. Then here comes Santana Dotson. Now Pavlis just sees his receiver, Gary Oliver, and throws it up for grabs. And watch Frankie Smith right there. Oh, what a great play.
Beautiful play. Great interception.
We have had some super defense by both sides.
And you hate to say the offense is sputtering because I think the defense is just making some great plays.
Well, when you get as many hits, great hits as you've had, it has something certainly to do with the way the defense is playing. Two tight ends again.
Baylor gets new life. High formation. Murray and Raphael. That will be Raphael at the 20.
Calvin Raphael.
Great play by Terry Price again, Bill. He plays a tight end off and just makes a play.
Big plays by the defense. Both sides of the football. 11 minutes now left to play in the game. Baylor had some time-consuming drives in the third quarter to keep it away from A&M. Bears would love one here. Leading 8-0.
Illegal procedure.
Flag day.
Baylor. Illegal procedure. I think the right guard and the right tackle moved up to the line of scrimmage. I don't know why they got that kind of movement.
Bassbinder's right there in the conversation. He's the small one on the offensive line. He's only at 275.
Yeah, and he probably doesn't get to eat enough at the training table.
Offense.
So Wendell Shelton and his crew have had a busy day. Brad Taft trying to hold on. Texas has defeated Arkansas. So the Longhorns number one. Arkansas is now with one defeat. And the winner here will have only one loss in Southwest Conference play. And jumping off sides, Gary Camp for Baylor.
Gary's brother Brian played here at Baylor, his offensive lineman.
You know what really hurts you as a coach? That's a dead ball violation, so you lose yardage without any time going off the clock whatsoever.
Nothing runs off at all. That's two of those now. 10 yards. Now the ball's back in a mishandled football or a big play by A&M right now, and you could be back in trouble again.
10:30 left to play. 8-0. Coleman.
Clip.
Raphael, I should say, a flag again on the play. Got to about the 18. Jeroy Robinson made the tackle for A&M. Let's see what the penalty is.
It's either clipping or holding on the outside receiver, cracking back inside. Locked below the knees.
Three plays, three penalties.
Watch at the bottom of the screen. You'll see him come back inside and just wipe that guy out. I don't know. Maybe may not see. There it is. See it at the top of the screen there. Good ball carrying by Raphael. It just this would be half the distance.
Block below the waist by the offense. Half the distance. Repeat second down.
All A&M has to do, though, Ray, is try to hold here and get that ball back because you're still can get a tie. And what did you talk about a tie before the game?
Well, you and I were talking about that. I'm sure both staffs have discussed the eventuality if it came down to we want to go for the tie or for the win. Two losses characteristically has not been in the Southwest Conference race, so a tie and a loss might be better, you know, stacking everything up than two losses. So, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of wheels turning over there. If we get the opportunity, we go for two for the tie. You know, are we going to try to press up field and win? You know, depending upon time and wind and all those conditions. But right now, Texas A&M seems to have a little bit of the momentum on their side.
So, again, it goes back to the call that Grant Taft made when he went for it on fourth and one. Had he kicked the field goal, he would be 11-0 right now. But A&M still with a chance to tie the game.
Yeah, but you know, Bill, from having been down there,
it will be third down.
It's, you know, you got to decide on what you think your kids are capable of doing and then go with your gut feeling. I wouldn't second-guess Grant Taft for that, although I'm now sure he's hindsight. I wish I'd have kicked it.
Yeah, hindsight's 20-20.
You're exactly right.
Third down now, Baylor 8. A&M refused the penalty. They wanted to make A&M take the down. There's the storyline for you. Time remaining, score of the game. Big defensive play, big play for both schools. Raphael and Gilstrap in the lineup. Raphael will run right.
Good pursuit by A&M. Wraps him up at the 22, no gain.
Great play by Terry Price again. He played the tight end off. Bill, you're talking about hindsight. That alumni hindsight's always 20-20.
Yeah, well.
Or sometimes it's even better than that. What's the best it can be, 20-20?
I'd have to ask Clark Kent.
Oh, okay.
William Thomas, Jason Black, and now the punting duties fall to Mr. Rutter. Pete Rutter with a 44-yard average. Buzzy Sawyer in 84 and 85 punted a little better than that, but Rutter, Mickey Washington will be back at his 30. Rutter with the wind to his back.
You remember, Bill, Buzzy Sawyer was a transfer from Texas A&M.
Mm-hmm. Always had a good kicking. He'll be inside his 10-yard line. What's the discussion about now? Time? I think the clock is stopped.
When you're playing at home, you ought to never have any trouble with the clock operator.
Now it's going again. They're going to run it down. To 9:23. That's the time remaining in the fourth quarter. Baylor leads it 8-0 over A&M.
Texas A&M has got nine men up within about 6 or 7 yards of the line of scrimmage, but I would imagine, based on the way Rutter hits the ball, they're going to go for the return here with Mickey Washington. We've got a penalty flag now.
Well, there's a penalty on the field. We'll check it when we come back. We're going to take a break at 9:03. Left in the fourth quarter, the Aggies have the football, but they'll be 80 yards away from Pater.
Now get that picture-perfect look with Benjamin Moore Regal Paints. Regal Wall Satin for a beautiful flat finish. Regal Aqua Velvet for a slightly higher sheen. And Regal Aqua Glow, a glossier paint. All three are washable, durable, and spatter-resistant. Benjamin Moore Regal Paints for that picture-perfect look.
See your independent Benjamin Moore paint dealer.
Great players and great teams are already preparing to give 100%. Experience the entertainment of the 1990 Mobile Cotton Bowl Classic.
Discussion. I'll tell you what, the referees are going to have laryngitis when this game is over. They've done so much jabbering back and forth.
That and their right arms are all going to be an analgesic bomb from throwing those something. They ought to retire all those flags after this one.
I think maybe a Baylor player may have pushed an Aggie in the back, and if that's the case, A&M may want him to punt that over again.
Yeah, I think the penalty is against Baylor.
78 yards from the line of scrimmage for Rutter, but he was inside his 10, so from where he punted it, it went 90 yards. Wow, what a punt. They're going to be clipping against Baylor. Grant Taft says, what's going on here?
I like Reggie Howard's look. He just threw both hands up in the air like, hey.
It's a tape-delayed game, you know. If we cut Wendell out of this game, we'll pick up an hour.
Yeah.
Well, he's going to be mad if we cut him out. Coach Taft's trying to get him to come to the sideline and talk to him, but he won't come without charging him a timeout if he's wrong, see? And he can't afford to lose a timeout.
All right, now Rutter, as you see, is about 3 or 4 yards deep in his own end zone. So the Aggies get a huge break on that. Oh, he dropped it. He dropped it. It's in the end zone. Touchdown. The Aggies. Touchdown, Aggies. Oh, what a turnaround.
Unbelievable.
Punted the ball 78 yards. The Aggies looked like they were going to have to go 80. There was a clipping on the play. Chris Crooms comes in. Rutter drops it, and Crooms makes the recovery. So the sophomore from Baytown, Lee, is the man of the hour for the Aggies. Now, A&M will go for two in a tie with 8:57 left to play.
Going to sprint down here to the bottom, go out in the flat, up in the end zone. There he is.
Pavlos, he's got Waddle. Two-point conversion is good, and just like that, the Aggies have tied it at 8. Wait a minute. The referees are talking again. What's this about? Is it no good? My goodness, there's a flag on the 10-yard line. Wait a minute. I'm tired of trying to second-guess the officials.
The point is not good.
The point is not good.
The penalty is for holding.
The penalty is for holding against the Aggies.
The penalty for a personal foul by the offense is declined. The score, that's the point, is not good.
Oh, boy. I'll tell you, the officials have played a large part in this game. They really have, Rick.
Yes.
They have changed the complexion of this game several times with their calls today.
Unfortunately, that's not the way it should be.
No.
But I'm sure they're making the calls as they see them.
R.C. Slocum can't be happy because, remember, against Texas Tech, he thought he had that game won on a fumble. The referee said it wasn't, and Texas Tech scored and won the game, so he is not going to be a big fan of the Zebras today.
What I don't understand is why they signaled the 2 points good. If it's a personal foul, you move the penalty and you get another shot.
On the extra point?
Sure. It's a play from scrimmage. If the pass was complete in the end zone was good, and then it's you play the down over again, or you play the play over again. He'll probably have to use a timeout for this, I would guess, if they stay by their normal rule.
Boy, I tell you, R.C. Slocum really has to feel like he's really having some problems with the officials. Now, on the extra point again, we're not going to see it, I understand, very well here, but you will signal that it's good. But see, this referee really doesn't make any difference here, this call, because the flag's thrown back out on the 10-yard line.
I know, but if it's good.
There he is. It's good.
If it's good, you in the penalty, then you replay the down. I don't know what RC found out over there, but that's, you know.
Well, there's the story right now. 8:57 left to play, and it's still anybody's football game. Actually, because of a Baylor mistake, A&M was able to recover the fumbled punt to get the 6 points. So now another mistake takes 2 points away from A&M. So it's 8-6 Baylor with 8:57 left to play.
Baylor's does not have its hands team in the football game. I wouldn't anticipate A&M an onside kick in this situation, but then that may be the reason to do it even more.
Well, you might want to kick one high again. Let's see what Lane Talbot does. He's kicking into a stiff breeze, and he's going to pooch it down to about the 15-yard line. Trooper Taylor tough little youngster out of Cuero, Texas, is tackled by Deion Snow.
Still plenty of time, Bill. There's no need for any panic on anyone's part. The only disadvantage is punting, kicking field goal into the wind. They're going to have to be a little closer than they would if it was turned the other way.
So Brad Gable now will enter the game. The ball at the Baylor 31-yard line. Aaron Wallace is back in for A&M. Playing with a strep throat, turf toe. Didn't play much in the first half. Played a lot here in the second. David Frost in motion. Flip back, Raphael. Raphael's got some running room. 35 at the 40, and here's another flag. My goodness gracious. Disciplined, or are the referees seeing a little too much?
Well, it's difficult to say. I think they called another face mask penalty.
I'm telling you what, there's been a flag on every play.
The defense would be a 5-yard penalty from the end of the run, and it'd be a first down by you.
Sometimes, Bill, you know, during the week, you get directives from the Officials Association about certain things, and they get overexcited about it. Watch him reach through. That's the only thing I could figure it was, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
That's Aaron Wallace.
Yeah, got no quarrel with that call.
Yeah. It's a great job of Raphael staying on his feet after that. But again, you let him out of a big hole.
Yes, you do. The ball now at the Baylor 45-yard line. Murray and Raphael in the backfield. First and 10, Baylor. Hand off Raphael. Good, tough running into A&M territory.
Tell you, Bill, both running backs for Baylor, Raphael and Coleman, both have done a good job of carrying the football today for Baylor and have been very, very instrumental in their success.
Really has. Raphael has had some great numbers, especially here in this stadium.
You know, 20 rushes, 68 yards is not knocking them really dead, but against this kind of defense and carrying the ball the way he's carried, it's been impressive.
Clock still running at 8:10, remaining to play. 6 Baylor. Hand off. Raphael looking for running room. Good job by Terry Price, number 88. He cut him off at the pass. So right now, that 8-6 score, the blocked punt by James Francis has been the key play in the game.
Looks like William Thomas is down for Texas A&M, and that would be a really, really critical blow. Looks like either shoulder or maybe hand.
Boy, that's unfortunate. You're right. What a heck of a season he's having.
Boy, what a ball game he's played today. Gee, man. If they hadn't had him, it might have been a different story.
I didn't think I could see a better ball game than the one he played last week against Houston. In that game against Houston, he had 3 sacks and 12 tackles. Andre Ware thought he was his roommate.
Well, I tell you what, boy, he has played very well today again.
One of the Aggie-L leaders. The spirit of Aggieland. And I know they're all concerned right now with the condition of that young man, William Thomas, the junior from Amarillo.
I'm Dale Campbell. For all your Baylor highlights and the best in New England,
well, let's hope he just had the wind knocked out of him and he'll be back in action. Yeah, he looks okay. That's good news.
He's carrying that left shoulder a little bit.
Yeah, he is, isn't he?
Might have been a little bit of a burner in there, and if he can get that.
Oh, he hit his own man, Price, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would look for him to be back fairly quick.
Third down and 3 for Baylor. The ball. 47-yard line. That's Frost in motion. Raphael left side, blocked by Murray, and big defensive play by Jeroy Robinson and Aaron Wallace.
Aaron Wallace caused the play to occur by getting upfield penetration.
And a flag is thrown at the Baylor bench. Dead ball, and it's going to be, I think, against Mickey Washington is what.
Well,
our spotters are saying, but let's wait and see. It might.
It's 24 for Baylor, number 1 for Texas A&M.
Mm-hmm.
We're in the altercation.
Murray and Washington. Came after the play now, so the A&M had held Baylor and forced fourth down.
personal foul, offense. It will be fourth down.
You know, Bill, in those situations there, a lot of times the second guy is the one that suffers the penalty. It always happens. Invariably, it happens anyway. And I didn't see it, so I don't know, but that happens so many times.
Well, big play, and now Pete Rutter will go back to his 24-yard line, and Washington will be deep for the Aggies. They came for the blitz and tried to get a block, and he let it go, and it'll be a touchback, and A&M will get it out on the 20-yard line. So I'm kind of surprised that Washington let that one go, because had that ended up inside the 10, it would have been big trouble.
But Bill, I think that they were bringing all 10 people on the rush and trying to get after it, and he may not have felt like the blocking was there, and with the wind blowing, it was going into the end zone. He did a good job of getting on the 10 and not backing up for it.
Well, join us for our next Southwest Conference game. It'll be 1 week from today when SMU takes on North Texas. It's a battle of two schools very close together up there in North Texas, and should be an exciting one. We'll have it for you on HSE. First and 10 now for Pavlis. Wilson, Lewis in the backfield. Lewis behind Wilson. Baylor pursuit, just too tough. Curtis Hafford and Santana Dotson on the pursuit.
Great job by Hafford and Dotson both.
They have had a tremendous they've had a tremendous game today.
They're just stringing it all to the sideline, Bill, when you're trying to turn it up. The Baylor pursuit has been excellent.
As we pointed out earlier, the defense for both schools can be very proud. They have played a whale of a game. The offense, in some instances on both sides, has been just simply overwhelmed by the defense. 6:23 left to play, and now time starting to become a factor. A&M going against a 25-mile-per-hour breeze. I formation, second needing 12. Mike Jones was in motion. Pavlis looked for him. There he is. Intercepted by Blackman. He's at the 40. He's got blocking. 30, 25, 15, 10, 5. Robert Blackman down to the A&M 5-yard line before Lance Pavlis had the save.
Great play, but Bill, the ball should have never been thrown. There's a guy running with him, and then a guy on top of him.
We have so many big play performers defensively in this game, and here's another one. Robert Blackman, an All-American candidate out of Van Vleck. Look at that interception. Isn't that something? And remember, the ball had been tipped by James Francis.
Right. Hey, Baylor did a great job of redirecting here and getting themselves upfield to block for Blackman as he ran the ball up the sideline.
So, just like that, the ball is back on the A&M 11. They say that Blackman ran out of bounds before he got there, so Raphael is wrapped up. James Webb was the first one to him. Of course, a field goal now by Baylor with 5:51 left to play would be an awfully large score. It would make A&M have to go for a touchdown, and one of the Baylor Bears is down. And it looks like the big one, John Turnpaugh. Oh, no, they're looking at that knee.
Well, hopefully it's just a bruise.
Turnpaugh has really been up. Pleasant surprise for the coaching staff. 6'2", 330 pounds out of Aldine Nimitz, a sophomore.
At the half, I was talking to some pro scouts over there in the press box. We were talking about how well he ran when he pulled a minute ago, or in the first half when he turned upfield. Really, really looked good motor for a guy 330 pounds.
Mike Hollaback is here, the general manager of the Houston Oilers, and
he's got his chauffeur, C. Obricato, with him.
He loves to watch football games. Mike Hollaback.
There, Mike's a general manager now, and he's still out scouting.
Well, that looks good. That's good news for Baylor. Turnpaugh walking up, off on his own power, but now some problems for R.C. Slocum. His defense has to hold. There's no tomorrow for A&M. It's right now. Second down and 12. Nice cut by Raphael. But that Aggie pursuit led by Mickey Washington too much. Boy, they are quick.
Yeah. He made a great initial cut, but one of the things that happened that he would like to avoid was getting out of bounds, Bill. He needed to turn it up inside if he could and stay in bound.
That's a good point. Keep that clock going, huh?
You bet. That's a great cut. Now watch the Aggies, though. You can see their team speed. Look at all the white shirts that get over there.
Yeah, Horton did a good job of stretching it out also. So now you might want to keep an eye on Goforth. Possession type receiver lined up on the left side. Bobby Jack Goforth. Third down, Gable. Nope. Going to flip it right side, Raphael, and a tackle. Good play made by Anthony Williams and Gary Jones.
Bill, you got to give a lot of credit to Texas A&M's defense. They had a critical turnover. They could have gone in and rolled over and died. It was a quick turnover kind of deal. They've come in and responded. Better gets a field goal, they can still win with a touchdown. So you got to give their defense an awful lot of credit at this point.
Jeff Ireland is perfect today, 2 of 2 in the field goal department. He is 10 of 13 on the season. This will come from the 21-yard line. It'll be a 31-yard attempt. It is good. Jeff Ireland, 3 of 3 today. So Ireland has provided all of the points for Baylor, and James Francis has blocked a punt for a safety. And Baylor now leads it 11 to 6 over the Aggies with 4:48 left to play. Don't go away.
For over 75 million years, sea turtles have played in the Earth's waters, laid eggs on her beaches, and remained a valuable member of our planet's ecosystem. But unfortunately, sea turtles are now endangered and facing extinction because of the greatest obstacle to their survival, man. For many years, I've been using the turtle image as my corporate symbol. Over this time, I've learned a great deal about the plight of the sea turtle and mankind's essential role in wildlife protection. You see, despite being the sea turtle's greatest obstacle, we are also their greatest ally. Nonprofit groups like the Defenders of Wildlife are supporting scientific research, promoting public awareness, and providing information to conservation authorities everywhere. When a species becomes extinct, it is gone forever. If we can't protect our wildlife, how can we ultimately protect our own species? For information on saving the sea turtle, please contact the Defenders of Wildlife. Thank you.
Way that's... Now the Baylor cheerleader is pretty happy with the goings on right now as their team leads it 11-6, and of course that means that A&M now would have to go for 6 points to try to win this game. The field goal is out of the question.
You know, Bill, and that changes Baylor's defensive philosophy now, knowing that a field goal can't win the ball game. Now they play a little bit more conservative, making them throw the ball and get the ball upfield and try to get the touchdown. So that makes their thinking, or changes their thinking.
Ireland with 9 points today. So he has 47 on the season. Nice, good kick. Comes down to Larry Horton. Horton with great speed, and he gets across the 30 to the 32.
Great return, and he managed to get out of bounds, too, to stop the clock, so that was helpful.
Well, Jeff Ireland made the tackle, the kicker. Horton returned a 92-yard kickoff against LSU earlier this year, so he certainly has the ability to get it done. So the Aggies with good field position out to the 34-yard line, first and 10 with 4:41 left to play. Pavlis to Darren Lewis. And look at him get through a hole. I don't know how he did it. He got across the 40 to the 42-yard line. I thought he was wrapped up for no gain. Boy, the great ones find a way, don't they?
You bet.
All right, look. Looks like he's wrapped up right there.
Now, one of the things A&M can do right here, if they are able to go down and score, run enough time off that clock where Baylor doesn't get in position to kick that field goal with the wind. So they're not, I'm sure they're trying to time it as late as they not score too quick if they have the opportunity to score.
Well,
Boy, I score when I can.
Yeah, but you look at it from this way. You score right now, Baylor's got a chance to come back down. Well, and kick a field goal, depending upon whether A&M went for one or two to win or tie with the win. And we saw him kick one from 61 twice to warm it up.
3:47 left to play. Pavlis play action. First and 10. Trying to throw it out of bounds. He does. He had Mike Jones over there, but I don't think he really wanted to throw it to him. Greg Effinger had a lot of pressure on him, the 6'6", 255-pounder out of San Antonio Churchill. Pavlis, much maligned, very highly recruited quarterback out of Tomball, but his first couple of years, he never could seem to get his feet on the ground, but he has had a whale of a season this year.
Yeah, Bill, and I tell you, there's a difference in not knocking Tomball. There's just a difference at the level of competition.
Yeah, Coach Etheridge has done a super job there, hasn't he?
Oh, yeah. Every year they have a great football team.
Pavlis going to run. He's got lots of room. Baylor territory runs out of bounds, but he gets the first down at the Baylor 44-yard line. Robert Blackman runs him out of bounds, but that time young Lance showed you what a great athlete he is. Now watch him direct traffic, and all the time he might have been thinking about running it.
Well, and he also, again, uses good judgment by hitting the boundary, protects himself, and also gets out of bounds to stop the clock.
They knew right where that first down marker was. Well, he transfers it to the left arm.
Yeah, he puts it in his inside arm, and he ought to have kept it in his outside arm.
3:29 left to play. Pavlis play action, got plenty of time. He's going to throw across the middle. His receiver fell down. It was intended across the middle for Shane Garrett, and he fell down on the play, and Waddle was wide open, huh?
Looked like he had him beat up the middle.
Well, that's the most important appendage of the game right now, and that would be the foot of the youngster right there, Jeff Ireland. 9 points for Ireland. 11-6 Baylor. 3:23 left to play. Second down. Pavlis needs 10. Big rush by the Bears. Guess who? James Francis.
I tell you, Bill, what on the replay, watch Darren Lewis try to tackle him. He grabs his right leg. Watch him.
The only reason they didn't call a hold here is because he couldn't do it. Huh?
No, I'm sorry. Grabbed his left leg. I don't know whether we'll try to grab him or not.
Well, there's your first round draft choice, huh?
I'll tell you what, he has played extremely well today. I'd heard reports that he hadn't played as well and consistently this year. Boy, he's had a great football game against a great football team.
Well, a timeout has been taken on the field. Baylor 11-6, 3:10 left to play in the fourth period. You know, the Southwest Conference, you talk about the talent and how down the conference has been in the last 5 or 6 years or even in the decade of the 80s, Ray, but this season, the two best linebackers in the country played right here. Lamar Latham was the other youngster. He went out with an injury. He could file hardship and come back next year, but then you got Francis, and then you got Aaron Wallace of A&M and William Thomas.
I tell you what, there may be some better, but I'd like to see them play. All of those kids have great talent, and they're an exhibiting well. And the Southwest Conference has been a little bit down, but I think it's on its way back. The Kenny kid has played well for Baylor today. He just hadn't made as many great big plays as Francis has made.
All right, we're ready to get back to action. 3:10 left to play. Third down, the Aggies need 3:13 to keep it going. Pavlis, big rush, Baylor. He's got lots of running room. He can run for it. 45, 30. He's at the 15-yard line. Lance Pavlis with a huge play for the Aggies.
Bill, four wide receivers, everybody spread out.
This is a 31-yard run by young Lance Pavlis. Baylor had nobody on that side of the field.
Well, they had the four wide receivers. They were covering those people, and their lineman got spread out. He stepped up in the pocket and ran, and it happens to a lot of people.
So Pavlis now is doing it with his feet.
And he puts it in the wrong hand again. You know, when it starts transferring that darn ball, anything can happen. But, that must be a habit that he has gotten into. And old habits sometimes are difficult to break.
Well, I'll tell you what, the confidence of a young man, you just never know when they seem to arrive. And right now is his shining moment for Lance Pavlis. Can he lead the Aggies to pay dirt? Let's see, 2:58 left to play. Hand off Darren Lewis, right side, he gets inside the 10. Gary Joe Kenny wrapped him up. And now,
you see, Bill, 2:45 left. Too quick.
Yep. But the Aggies now have the clock, you could say, in their favor. Four down territory. It's running. 2:34, 2:33. Baylor has three timeouts left. A&M has two. Again, Lewis. Right side. He's down to about the 7. Robin Jones with a tackle for Baylor. Big blocks by Mike Arthur, Darren Groot, and Matt McCall.
Well, you like to see this. Matt McCall got up and helped Robin Jones up from Baylor, and they kind of pat on each other. Good, tough, physical football game, and it's been kept pretty well under control. Haven't been too many instances.
Now, A&M can get a first down at the 4-yard line. Third and 4 for the Aggies. Lewis, he's got it at the 3. First down, A&M. Boy, what a block on the left side by Mike Pappas and Richmond Webb. They just really cleaned it out along with Mike Arthur. Look at that, Richmond Webb at 291 pounds, and the Pro Scouts really like him.
I tell you, I'm glad I don't have to play anymore, Bill.
They're a little larger than when you played, huh?
Oh, yeah. And stronger and faster.
Clock running down. There's the time and the score. Ball on the 3-yard line. First and goal, A&M. Wilson, is he in? He's at the 1.
Coach Taft was trying to get a timeout. I don't know whether they...
The Aggies trying to stay alive for showdowns with Arkansas and Texas. Look at that sideline. 113, 112, 111. Aggies are going to let it run down as far as they can. They need a yard for a touchdown. And it's only right. Pavlis takes it in. It was his drive to start with.
Yeah, he did a great job in this drive. That's a big play and very good job of keeping his composure.
Well, the young man has lived up to his high school billing. This is a day for Lance Pavlis.
I'm sure the Aggies will go for 2, Bill.
Might as well. And Pavlis will call a timeout. I'll tell you, that A&M line just caved in the Baylor front four.
They really came off the football, and you can see he extends himself across the goal line. But it looks like A&M's gotten a timeout. We'll go for 2.
Mike Jones and Brian Ross were playing referee. Here's old Jim Helms over there. That's a good staff, too. We talked about Grant Taft's staff a little earlier, but Tom Hayes and Bob Toledo, Kirk Dahl, Robert Ford. Jim Helms is over there talking it over, too, in that huddle. And John Pierce
Jim.
Out of Willow Ridge High
right.
School.
Oh, John, Jim Helms has seen a few kickoffs.
Boy, has he? Great running back at Texas
right.
Years ago. Well, now Grant Taft will get the football. And remember, Baylor has three timeouts left. And the wind to the Bears' back with 1 minute left to play.
I'd be curious to see what Texas A&M does if they put the ball on the hash and use a motion play and trips into this sideline again like they did.
Remember now, if they throw the ball and Baylor can return it, it's 2 points the other way.
And that makes it 13-12. See, Warrell, you're a snake in the grass, boy.
Well, that's
right.
The rule that was put in last
you're
year.
Right.
So you have to be awfully careful if you put the ball in the air that the other team doesn't intercept. A&M going for 2. Now inside handoff, Wilson, he's got it. And the Aggies have taken a 14-11 lead. And now all the Bears can do is tie it with a field goal. It makes Baylor have to go for a touch.
Bill, that was a great call by the Texas A&M offensive staff. That was a great call by the Baylor offensive staff.
Oh, look at that block on the left side by Mike Pappas. Richmond Webb was sealing off. Mike Arthur, the offensive line. line for A&M has taken charge here in the fourth quarter.
I believe that was just a simple draw play to Wilson and really well executed. It was a great call.
In 1974, they called it the Miracle on the Brazos when Baylor went to the Cotton Bowl. A&M may look back at this small miracle on the Brazos if they hold on and win this game and go to the Cotton Bowl.
Well, this will be one of their all-time great comebacks, I promise you that, and particularly in light of the fact that I don't think they started off playing just really, really with full intensity at the beginning of the ballgame, and Baylor had something to do with that, I'm sure.
Well, what a great game it's been for James Francis in the defense. Now the Aggies imploring A&M to cover that kick. Now, here's another thing to keep an eye on. Lane Talbot will be kicking off at his own 35, but that wind blowing, really, I think it's picked up over 25 miles per hour now, so Baylor should get good field position here.
And he's going to, I'm sure, try to squib kick it and get a crazy bounce.
Somebody got to pick it up and go with it. Straight up. He's got a hole. There's Trooper Taylor at the 40. He's at the 45, and he's midfield. Trooper Taylor out of Quero. And the Bears are back down on the A&M 48-yard line with 55 seconds and all three timeouts.
Holy Moses.
Oh, how this game of college football can change. Look at Trooper. He said, hey, man, I see a big gap here.
He couldn't see it probably as well as we could see it up here in the scene. But you know what? When the ball rolls around on the ground, everybody kind of relaxes and converges in one area usually, and that can sometimes create some big plays.
They got a running back named Straight from Quero they're talking about. They may be talking about Trooper today, however.
Blitz.
Gable. Got Frost at the 43. Larry Horton made the tackle for A&M. 46 seconds left to play in the game, and a timeout taken by Baylor because he couldn't get out of bounds. Good job by Horton to keep the receiver in bounds, so now Baylor has two timeouts remaining. A&M has one. The Aggies lead by three. Well, the big one, of course, was the 31-yard keeper by Pavlis down to the Baylor 15-yard line on third down, or fourth down, I should say, for the Aggies. So the big fourth down play by Pavlis kept the drive alive. Now let's see what Gable can do. Baylor with two timeouts. Those are the stats on Brad Gable today. Another good day for Gable, although a couple of interceptions. But against a very good A&M defense.
I'm trying to find Jeff Ireland over on the sideline, but I don't see him.
Gable, going to go long, looking for Miller. Oh. Just off his fingertips at the four-yard line. Reggie Miller almost had six. Horton was there in coverage, but Miller, just a matter of inches. Boy, Gable really threw this
one. Yeah, this is a nice throw. Maybe a little bit far upfield.
Oh, Horton got turned around.
Yeah. You know, that's an interesting call. I'm sure A&M may be playing for him to peck underneath a little bit, and he went deep with it.
All right, keep an eye on Stutzman, the big tight end. He's lined up to the left side. Two wide receivers in the game. Gable going to go to one of his wide receivers, Greg Anderson. He couldn't hold on at the 33-yard line, and now it's down to fourth and four for Baylor. And here's the old ball game. 36 seconds. Now Pavlis converted on a big fourth down play for the Aggies. Let's see what Gable can do. I think Grant Taft may want to call a timeout. He'll have one left. Too big a play not to talk it over.
Yeah. Well, you've got to make sure everybody's on the same page in these situations here. And I'm sure Coach Taft's philosophy is based on this, and we're going to go for the win.
Well, at halftime, in case you joined us late, at halftime, Baylor led it 8-0 and held the ball the entire third period.
Well, now here comes field goal kicker, Ireland.
Well,
goes back to what we were talking about a minute ago, Bill. The tie may be more beneficial to him than going for it and losing.
So it's going to be up to Jeff Ireland. He has already done it today. He has 3 for 3. This ball, we surmise, will be at about the 50-yard line. It'll be a kick of 60 yards or more, maybe 61. And Ray, as you observed in pregame, he was kicking at 61 and then some.
Yeah, he hit two from there that went well past the goalpost. So.
Ireland?
You know what's tragic is this, all this is coming down on this guy's shoulders now. He's got a chance to be the hero or in a lot of people's mind, the GOAT, which is erroneous, I think.
All right, he's got a heck of a leg. Now, his holder is Kent Brentham. Snapper is Scott McCool, who has played the entire game as a backup to Mark Bass. So Grant Taft